Good morning, everyone. Just a reminder that two reminders. One is that the photo, the group photo, will take place today at 2:15 on the stairs of the Scuola Normale in Piazza dei Cavalieri. And second, that the coffee break will be at 10, so after Gabriel's lectures. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I will wait for everyone to have a seat. So the goal of today is to present some kind of a general methodology to approximate optimal transport. So yesterday we saw Monge formulation, then Kantorovich formulation, which is basically a linear program, which might be a very large scale for machine learning or imaging application. So the goal is to have like faster algorithm. And also I want to touch on the question of sample complexity. So how many samples do you actually need to solve your problems? And this would be also key. So using regularization would be, as you probably know from machine learning, a key aspect to obtain an efficient method in high dimensions. Okay, so let me give more or less first the intuition of entropic regularization, and then try to formalize a bit and speak about convergence. So the idea is actually very old. You can trace this idea back to statistical physics, for instance, work of Schrödinger on modeling of gas. He was trying to have this kind of question of you have particles of gas at two instants of time, and you would like to somehow reconstruct the most likely trajectory. So if there would be, the gas would be deterministic particles, they would basically follow probably an optimal transport. But of course, there is also some kind of statistical noise of a Brownian motion that you need to take into account in the model. And he introduced a temperature that would be the epsilon parameter here. So what we'll do here is simply we come back to the initial Kantorovich problem. So Kantorovich problem is just this part here. So this is the cost we pay for each particle that we send, each unit of mass. Here, for simplicity, I just say it's a distance to the power p, but you can take any distance. Here, it's a shorthand notation to say p as marginal a and b, so maybe I should recall what it is. So u and ab is the transportation polytope. So it's a set of positive matrices that satisfies p1 is a and p transpose 1 is b. So it's a convex polytope. And of course, the novelty here is we add a little bit of some penalty, which is taken here to be the Shannon entropy. So it's minus the entropy. So you try to have something that not only solves the optimal transport problem, at least approximately, but has some entropy. So it's a bit diffuse. So it's the Shannon Boltzmann entropy, so the sum of Pij, log of Pij. And here, just for sake of normalization, I've taken the entropy, the relative entropy, with respect to the input measure. So remember that the natural input measure that you have when you are given A and B on the product space is A tensor B, which is just the set of EIBJ. Okay, so it's kind of the natural measure, so it gives you some reference. It's very good with transport, because since you are given two marginal, you always at least has some reference you can use, for instance, to define entropy, because you know that entropy, you always need some reference to define it. And here it's very natural to take this one. In fact, you can choose any one as long as it has the same support. Okay, but A and B, it makes a lot of sense. And for later on, when I will do a bit of theory on this, actually, it will be useful to have this normalization. But for now, it's not really a big deal. For the algorithm, you could take other reference measure. And let's try to have a look, before speaking about the algorithm, of what is the impact of this entropy. Okay, the impact is a diffusion, but what it is exactly? So here, on the first row, you see the optimal matching problem. So recall that when you have two measures that are just point clouds with the same number of points, Monge and Kantorovich are equivalent according to Birkhoff-Fundeman theorem, and it gives you the optimal permutation, so very sparse matrix P. So P is just a permutation. And as you increase epsilon, somehow the matrix will become dense. In fact, and we'll see this in the theory after, that immediately if epsilon is strictly positive, then P becomes non-sparse, becomes full. But of course, most of these entries will be very small. So here, I'm just displaying those entries that are larger than 10 to the minus 3. And I display what happened when epsilon increases. And as epsilon increases, what you will have is more and more connection in some sense. the transport solution would become more and more full, and you would have more and more connection. Here there is a connection each time Pij is larger than some threshold. And when epsilon goes to plus infinity, if the temperature becomes very hot, then everybody will talk to everyone. So it's a totally non-transport case. Actually, it's quite intuitive. As epsilon tends to infinity, this is this entropy that tends to dominate everyone. And you know that the relative entropy is zero if and only if these two agrees. So in the large temperature limits, the solution that you would get is simply AIBJ, which is totally non-transport because it connects everyone to everyone. Right, so this is the intuition. Epsilon will play the role of having more and more connection. And the big impact, and we'll see this later, is as epsilon increases, the algorithm will be more and more efficient, so more and more effective, converge faster and faster. And also, we'll see this in the high dimensional regime. You would have something that is more and more robust, more and more easy to estimate in high dimension. Okay, so it has really the two key roles, is to accelerate the algorithm, and also to have something that is more robust in high dimension. Because intuitively, if you have something that is very sparse, a solution that is very sparse of a linear program, if you perturbate a little bit your linear program by changing A, B, or the cost, for instance, doing a little bit of perturbation, then you will see this little arrow that jumps all over the place. Like typically, a solution of a linear program is typically quite unstable, and sometimes actually you have no unique solution. For optimal transport in general, it's not necessarily unique, so by perturbating, you could change a lot the solution. Whether as epsilon increases, things will become more and more stable. Actually, you can show that if epsilon is strictly positive, the dependency of the solution with respect to all the parameters is like totally smooth, totally C infinity. Okay? And intuitively, it's what happens every time you do regularization. What you do is instead of having a very flat function, so this is just a linear function, you perturbate it to give him a little bit of curvature, a little bit of strict convexity, and then things become easier, optimization is faster, and things are much more stable. So in theory, we could use other regularization than x log x. But really, what you would see later is this special choice of the entropy is the key. Because this is the one that will give a very nice algorithm and very nice theory. And it's really the idea that you also see in statistics for those who have done estimator using a max entropy method. This is just a max entropy method on the optimal transport, if you want. So it's really like something very classical, so very old, but that I've seen recently a huge revival in machine learning because it's really something that can be used efficiently in machine learning. It has really opened the door to using optimal transport in many fields that was not possible before. All right, this is another example. This is somehow the totally opposite example. I would call this the Birkhoff-Hahnemann example, and this would be more the Yann Brunier example if you want. It's the example where you couple measures which have a density with respect to Lebesgue. And then because of Yann Brunier's theorem, you know that Monge and Kantorovich are equivalent in the sense that the solution to Kantorovich would be located on a functional map, on a Monge map. So it will be very sparse, actually, so it's hard to see, but the solution is located on a curve. And since in 1D, actually, it's an increasing curve, what I told you yesterday is that the solution in 1D is always an increasing function. So this is the increasing Monge map, and as epsilon increases, the solution would not be anymore located on a curve, it would be diffused. And it's really a bit like if you apply a heat diffusion or a Gaussian diffusion to this solution. So not exactly this, it's a bit more complicated, but the intuition is really what you obtain by adding this temperature is diffusion of the transport plant. It's kind of a diffusion where you keep the marginal if you want. So it's something like quite clever actually. And as epsilon increases, you have more and more diffusion, and at the end you end up having the product of the two marginal, so totally diffuse solution. So it's the same phenomena, but on two different setups. All right, so it's really to give the intuition that the temperature would give something more smooth. If you do image processing or signal processing, this would be like a denoising of the transport plan. Like back diffusion, you remove the noise. So you can also interpret this as some kind of a way to introduce denoising, to remove like small details. It's like blurring the problem, which you probably all know that in machine learning it's very important to blur things if you go to high dimension. Like Kernel's method, they are basically based on blurring things. Okay, so this was for the discrete problem. As you might guess, you can re-express everything for arbitrary measure. You simply replace sum by integrals. So this would be the relative entropy for arbitrary measure. It's exactly the same, but here you take the relative density between your coupling and the input marginals. And probably you also know this naming, but in information theory, This quantity, the relative entropy, is also known as the Kullback-Leibler divergence. It's a divergence, so it's a way to compare two measures. It's a bit like a distance, but it's non-symmetric, if you want. Schrödinger problem in full generality would be this problem, where you have the optimal transport cost plus epsilon times the Kullback-Leibler divergence between your coupling and the totally dumb, if you want, independent coupling. So it's very old, but of course its use as an algorithm is more recent, although you can also find trace of this idea a long time ago. Oh, it's okay for everyone, so don't hesitate to ask questions if I'm going too fast on this. So what would be the algorithm, and how can you derive it? I will explain this maybe a bit later. First, for those who are probabilists in the room, I already said that optimal transport has a nice probabilistic interpretation where you view the coupling pi as just a couple of two random vectors x and y, where x has the law of alpha and y has the law of beta. And the couple xy carries on the coupling, carry on the dependency structure between your two variables that you solve using an optimal transport problem. And in fact, the Kullback-Leibler divergence, if you interpret this in terms of probability, it's what is called the mutual information. The mutual information between two random vectors. And the intuition is it measures the deviation between the couple, between how much the couple are independent, how much x and y are independent, because it's zero if and only if pi is equal to alpha times beta. And the fact that the law is equal to the product of the marginal is exactly the definition of independence. Okay, so this is like a penalty you pay in order to be more independent, if you want. So I think it's also good to I forgot to mention this guy, so Christian Léonard. He's not the only one, but he's one of the specialists of Schrödinger problem. So Schrödinger problem, there is a lot of mathematics behind it to try to analyze it and understand it. And if you read the paper of Christian, there is a very nice overview, historical overview. He discusses the original paper of Schrödinger with modern language, so it's really nice. So if you want to know more about the physics, the modelings, and also mathematical results, I think you should read Christian's surveys on this. But come back to independence. You can really view this problem as a way somehow to interpolate between total dependency and total independency. Okay, if you look at the case of Yann Brunier, Yann Brunier's theorem tells you that you have a Monge map. So basically, it tells you that y is a deterministic function of x. So when epsilon is zero, the solution to this problem would be y being totally dependent on x because of Yann Brunier's theorem. And if epsilon goes to infinity, well, it's exactly the opposite. You obtain that x and y are totally independent. So you can interpret this as a diffusion on the density, but on the probability, you can interpret this as introducing more and more independence between the variable, which is a nice way to regularize the problem. For those who are interested in more like dynamical formulation, and I didn't really explain what I mean by this, but I gave the intuition of McCann interpolation at the beginning, meaning that optimal transport, once you have the optimal transport, you can describe an interpolation by just having particles that move along the segments with constant speed. And this is actually a geodesic. I mean, it's a way to interpolate between two probability distribution over the Wasserstein space, often called the McCann interpolation. In fact, you can also have a similar interpretation for this problem. I will not write this, but you can also use this problem as solving also a transportation problem. But now it's not anymore a deterministic transportation, it's a fuzzy transportation. And this is a display of what happened. As epsilon increases, you have two phenomena that appears. First, you have the fact I've already said before that instead of linking this guy to this guy and having like a one-to-one map, you get more diffusion. So this particle, instead of just moving here, it will also move a bit here. And actually, it would move everywhere, but probably mostly here and here. And if you go to epsilon very large, this particle will move here, will move here, will move here, move everywhere. So the first phenomena is as epsilon increases, you have more and more connection between the points. This is what I've already said before. But also, the interpolation itself becomes non-deterministic because it becomes linked by what is called a Brownian bridge. A Brownian bridge is just a Brownian motion where you fix the start and the ending point. So you condition your Brownian motion by saying, I want my Brownian motion to go from here to here. Okay, so the interpretation is as epsilon increases, the Brownian bridge becomes more and more diffuse. So you're going to spread more and more the mass. Okay, and the Brownian bridge, if you stop the Brownian bridge at some time, is just a Gaussian distribution. Okay, so it's like interpolating. Instead of having a point that moves, you have like a little Gaussian that moves. So I'm not writing down the equation, but you can write the equation and formulate a dynamical formulation. It's explained in the paper of Christian, but for me, I will not use it because I will simply stick to the Kantorovich problem, which is basically the one we'll solve for the algorithm. But there is also a very nice interpretation that is used a lot for many problems, including theoretical problems. All right, so just like different intuition, different explanation of the same phenomena, the idea that you introduce some regularization to make the problem easier. I will skip this, just an animation. For those who like copula, just a display of the copula to just highlight the fact that it's interpolated between total dependency and total independency, but I will not comment on this, it's not very important. I want to spend some time on is the derivation of the algorithm, because it's very simple. Actually, I think it's the most simple algorithm you can think of if you want to solve optimal transport. So I also like to teach this because it's useful for the students to code the algorithm themselves. Because if you ask a student to code a simplex, nobody will be able to do it. It's just too complicated. Whereas this algorithm is very easy, and they can start playing with optimal transport in like half an hour. So it's really nice. And maybe later, or maybe tomorrow, I will show you actually the codes and numerics, so that if you are interested, you can also code it yourself. Because I strongly support the fact that you should not only read the math, you should also implement them, because it's this way you will learn the math much easier. And you will understand the phenomena that happens, which are not always trivial. So it's very good to have the equation and to simulation at the same time to really have a feeling of what's happening. So I will probably do a zoom on numerics maybe tomorrow morning. So the very important proposition is this one, and it's a proposition that you might be familiar with if you have already seen maximum entropy method, which is a very general theorem that when you have a maximum entropy minimization, the solution can always be written as the form of a Gibbs kernel, a Gibbs energy. And this is just rephrasing this in this specific case. And the proposition goes like this. It says that first, this problem is actually strictly convex, because this function is strictly convex, so there is always a single solution. And this single solution can be characterized by the fact that there will be the conservation of mass, of course, but there will be a factorization of your solution using a Gibbs kernel. So what is the Gibbs kernel? The Gibbs kernel is just exponential minus the cost divided by epsilon. So you can think of this Gibbs kernel as being, in this case, just a big matrix. If you think about the case where d is the Euclidean distance and p is 2, this matrix is a Gaussian kernel. So you can factorize your problem using a Gaussian blurring, multiply on the left and on the right by what are called diagonal scaling. It means that each row of this matrix is multiplied by a scalar ui, and each column is multiplied by a scalar vj. So in terms of matrix notation, which I think is the way you should remember this, it means that capital P can be written as the product of a diagonal matrix U multiplied by K multiplied by a diagonal matrix V. So you are solution to the problem if and only if you satisfy this equation and this equation. And now the unknown are U and V, which are positive vector, two set of positive vectors. So instead, you have to look for a big matrix of size n times n. You now have to look for two vectors, which is quite cool because it saves some storage and it's easier to manipulate. Usually, this kernel is very structured, so it's also quite good because you can store it efficiently, for instance, in many cases. And the idea is now you would solve for U and V. So U and V are called the multiplication, the scaling multiplicator, or the scaling factors. And in fact, this problem, which I recall you is a Schrödinger problem, so the intuition came from optimal transport, is a problem that was used a lot actually in statistics and in tabular data manipulation a long time ago, much before actually optimal transport. It's the problem of you have some kernel, some matrix of value, arbitrary, and you want to scale them. You want to multiply the row and the column by some scalar. So you want to normalize your array of number in order to have fixed sums here and here. And the most common case that people were using to normalize arrays is the case of bistochastic matrices. So actually, it's a huge, I mean, it's a big problem that people have asked for years. Is it always possible, giving an array of number, to normalize it so that it becomes bistochastic? Okay, so the bistochastic scaling problem was known a long time ago, much before optimal transport. Actually, in the 30s, it was already studied. In full generality, it's a difficult problem. It's more or less solved, and now people understand more or less everything, because the difficulty is when k has some zero in it, and sometimes it's actually not possible. But if k is a strictly positive matrix, it means it's a Gibbs kernel. Well, I just proved to you that there is always a unique solution, because this is a convex optimization problem and it has a unique solution. So first, it allows you to solve the problem trivially. Is if k is strictly positive, there exists a unique u and v such that p is bistochastic. Okay, so it's nice, it's solved theoretically a problem that seen like this is not so obvious. Maybe I can comment on the proof, just why it's true, but those that have done maximum entropy methods, they already know what happened. Well, what happened is you simply write down the first order condition for this optimization problem. So remember that this optimization problem, it has two set of constraints, P1 equal A and P transpose 1 equal B. You have another constraint that is a bit problematic, but since there will be actually a logarithm in the derivative, it means more or less you can actually forget about this constraint. Okay, so you can introduce Lagrange multiplier for this one, but you would realize that they actually disappear. But for this one, what you would have is a Lagrange multiplier, let's denote it F. For this one, a Lagrange multiplier G. Okay, and the first order condition for this problem would be that the derivative of this guy plus the Lagrange multiplier is zero. So what is the derivative of this? The derivative of this is just the cost. So if I denote Cij the cost you have to pay, the derivative of the linear part will just be Cij. Then you have plus epsilon, the derivative of the entropy, but the derivative of the entropy is just the logarithm, which is basically the reason why people love entropy, because its derivative is the logarithm, so it turns product into sums and everything becomes very simple. So it's really why we are using entropy is just for this, is that the derivative would be log of Pij divided by Aij. And then you have the dual variable, the Lagrange multiplier for this, which will just be Fi, and the Lagrange multiplier for this will just be Dj, and this should be zero, right? And then what you do is you just put this guy P out of the equation, and you would have the fact that Pij would be Ai times Bj times exponential minus Cij divided by epsilon multiply by exponential of minus Fi divided by epsilon multiply by exp of Gj divided by epsilon. Okay, so I just took the exponential of this equation. And what you see is exactly this form. If you say that ui is ai times this, so if you regroup this one and this one together, this would give you ui. And if you regroup this one and this one together, this would give me vj. Okay, so this exponential form is nothing more than a simple rewriting of the first order condition of the problem. Okay, so now why is it useful? I mean, why is it useful? It's equivalent. So I'm not saying this is more easy or more complex. It's just two equivalent problems. So stated like this, I didn't really change anything. I've just turned an optimization problem into a nonlinear equation solving problem. So why is it useful? Well, it's useful if you can have some operative way if you want to solve the equation. And it turned out that if you look at what happened, what you need to solve is these two equations, P1 equal A and P transpose 1 equal B. So what I would do is I would simply multiply P1 and I would get diag of U times K times diag of V times 1. But diag of V times 1 is just V. If you multiply a diagonal matrix by 1, you get the vector. So you get V. So what you get here is you get the vector K times V, where this is a matrix and this is a vector. And if you multiply a vector by a diagonal matrix, it's just the pointwise multiplication of the two vectors. So it's going to be what I call u with a dot like this, times kv. This notation is just to say I multiply the two vectors together by multiplying entry-wise the vector. Okay. And what is the equation I need to solve? I need to solve that this should be A. So the conservation of mass for the rho is just this equation, which is the equation I will write here. So this equation that you have here is exactly equivalent to P times 1 equal B. And then you just reverse the rule and U and V, and you get V times K transpose U equal B. So the Schrödinger problem is equivalent to simply solving two nonlinear equations, which are polynomial equations of degree 2 in U and V and U and V. So how do you solve polynomial equations of degree 2 together? It's absolutely non-trivial. But here there is a hack. There is a very nice way to do this. Is if I give you V, it's very simple to compute U. What you do is you simply divide A by KV. So you have this quite naive algorithm, which is an iterative or fixed points algorithm, where you just cross the finger and you hope it converges. You first solve this equation for U and then solve this equation for V iteratively. And if it converges, well, you would have solved the problem, you would have solved Schrödinger problem, because it will satisfy these two fixed point equations, which I've said to you that are equivalent to minimizing this problem. So it's kind of a heuristic, and in general, if you do an iterative scheme, it never converges. I mean, unless you are very happy. And here, we are very lucky because it converges. And it's actually, this algorithm is often called Sinkhorn algorithm. And the reason is because Sinkhorn is a mathematician that proved its convergence. But it's an algorithm that is much older. It has many names, EPFP, RAS, there's a lot of names for this, but it's the same algorithm. I think there is two or three Wikipedia pages just for this algorithm because you can find several names for it. But I like to call it Sinkhorn in order to credit the mathematician that actually studied this algorithm and studied it seriously to prove convergence, because it's not so trivial to show convergence. Especially, I will explain later that not only it converges, but it's a contracting iteration. It contracts, meaning that it converges linearly. So the error you make decays at a geometric rate. Okay, which is very nice, very powerful, and it also introduces key concepts, because to prove contractance, you need to introduce some notion of distance. So it's really also a way to build a nice mathematics that people have studied a lot under the name nonlinear Perron-Frobenius theorem. Perron-Frobenius, and I will explain this later, but it's really a very beautiful algorithm. But for now, just let's say that it converges, and I will come back to this later. So it's a result from 64. So why do we like it in practice in terms of numerics? We like it in practice because the only difficulty of the algorithm in terms of numerics is the multiplication between a matrix and a vector. So at worst case, if you have no other solution, you just simply compute this matrix vector multiplication, so it would have a complexity of n squared. So intuitively, the complexity of the algorithm is the number of iterations times n squared. And of course, the number of iterations will depend on the accuracy you want to have. Okay, so then you can study this, and you can study how it grows with the epsilon and with the error you make. But the bottom line is it will have a complexity which is n squared, so square complexity in terms of dimension of the problem, and then some kind of a polynomial in epsilon, so polynomial in terms of the accuracy you have. So the take-home message I would like to convey is it's an algorithm that is very cheap in terms of n, but not very good in terms of accuracy. And as you all know, in optimization, there is no free lunch. If you want an algorithm that is very precise, usually it's scaled very poorly in N. If you think about like interior point method, well, simplex algorithm I told you about yesterday is super accurate because it has precision zero. I mean, it gives zero error. But the bottom line is the complexity is N cubed. Okay, so usually when you decrease the complexity in N of an algorithm, you usually pay a price in terms of epsilon. And here the trade-off is, We rather care for typical machine learning application of n, because n might be huge. Okay. So the good news is n can be quite huge, of the order of 10,000 and even millions, it's still okay. And the other very good news, it's an algorithm that is very simple to implement. Well, anyone can implement this, it's just like a division and a matrix multiplication, so it's two lines, it's really like two lines of Python. But also it's an algorithm that will scale very well on GPUs. GPUs being graphical processing unit is basically the tools we use for deep learning and modern machine learnings, because the GPU are designed to multiply tensors together, and it's also very nicely it deals very nicely with parallelization, meaning by this, if instead of having to solve just one optimal transport problem, you have to solve millions of optimal transport problems. What you do is just you stack them together. Okay, you just stack your vector as a big matrix. So each row of your matrix is one of your data sets. And then instead of having to deal with division and matrix vector multiplication, you just replace this by matrix-matrix multiplication. Instead of computing tons of k times v, you just compute like two big matrix multiplication. So really this algorithm, I think it makes sense when you do parallelism on GPU. This becomes a game changer, because if you want to do this with a simplex algorithm on GPU, I mean, I've never tried, but it's almost impossible. It will never scale like this would scale. So it's an algorithm that on a single CPU, it's okay, it's relatively fast. And I often receive emails of people say, yeah, I beat Syncorn because I have this crazy quasi-Newton, blah, 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 blah. But okay, but this algorithm is not designed to be on CPU. It's designed to do machine learning on GPU. And on GPU, honestly, it's hard to beat. Because, okay, you have such a degree of parallelism that even if it's a dumb algorithm, it scales nicely. So I think the take-home message is maximum entropy method. They are powerful because they decouple the variables and they allow you to just use matrix operation. Well, I hope you get the message, but it's fairly important message. Is this algorithm is designed for parallelism, which is nice because the typical application we'll care about later would be like having huge data sets. All right.
Can I ask a question?
Sorry. Yep.
So you need to initialize the iteration. Yep. What is a good choice of an initialization?
So I think there is no good choice. If you know nothing about your problem, you initialize at one, which and I will explain it's linked to the dual problem. It's initializing the variable at zero. But if you are on a more controlled setup, typically on a grid, maybe low dimensional, what people do is they use a multi-scale strategy, which I will not explain because, okay, then it requires you to have like some domain-specific knowledge. But this algorithm fits also very nicely with all the ID on PDs, on numerical analysis, where you would typically refine the grid. And also what you can do, it helps a lot, is also to have like, could say scheduling of the epsilon or some kind of simulated annealing like, where you would have epsilon that progressively decay during the iteration. So the best implementation in low dimension, so where you can do things a bit clever, are implementation that do this temperature decay, like large scale and then low scale. And also they start by a coarse grid and progressively they refine the grid only near the Monge map. And then you get a huge speed up. But the problem is it becomes a nightmare to implement. So at some point, you have to decide whether you want to take times on theory and do like huge parallelism, or rather like I want to solve like a geometrical problem and then I will do refinement. So it is kind of, because then it's more difficult to implement. All right, so regarding this, it's a powerful algorithm. I've already said, but there's many people that work on this. Unfortunately, I never found a good picture of Syncorn, so if anyone has it, I would be happy. It's the guy on the background here. But he really did amazing work on this. This is the evolution, so it's related to your question. So usually you initialize by one, meaning that the initialization is just the kernel, the Gibbs kernel itself. So it's kind of close to the identity, it's a Gaussian kernel. And then you see the mass progressively like get shifted away until it reaches its stationary limit, which is close to the Monge map, or Bleur Monge map. So you really see the algorithm progressively will push the mass further away. And of course, if epsilon is large, it pushes more the mass. So it's blurry, but it goes faster. So the intuition is as epsilon goes to zero, the algorithm will become super slow. So it's really an algorithm that makes no sense if epsilon is too slow, too small, or if you start immediately by a very small epsilon, it will be super slow. So that's why it's important to use an epsilon that is large, and maybe after you can of course decay it to have a refinement. But if epsilon is small, there's no way around it, it's a slow algorithm. And it is the same, but in 3D. I've already said this, but you can, at least in theory, used other regularization, then the algorithm is more involved, unfortunately. So a typical regularization that people love is, of course, X-square regularizer, which has some good properties. You can have a Syncorn-like algorithm, but each iteration is much more costly because it's not anymore a matrix multiplication. But well, at least you can do it and it has a similar flavor. Except the advantage of having x squared is you get a solution which is exactly sparse. As opposed to syncon, where the solution is blurry, so it has infinite support. But in practice, I never found that it was really a problem. But I don't know why people are obsessed. Because, well, implementing this is quite difficult. But it's possible. Before like going into the theory, I wanted to highlight some variation on this idea of syncon that allow you to solve a lot of other problems in this galaxy of optimal transport-like problems. And I've selected only two problems, but there are a lot more. The first one is what I call unbalanced optimal transport, which is something that is very important in many applications, actually. It's try to answer the question of what happens if the input alpha and beta, they are not probability distribution. Like maybe you'd like to use it for shapes, and the shape has different areas. And then, it's not so clear what happened. You can always say, okay, I just normalize my input so that they become probability distribution, but it looks like a bit ad hoc, and it makes sense that there should be some kind of optimal transport theory for general measure. And also, the intuition is what you should do if you have two measures with different mass, is you should not only transport the mass, you should be able to somehow kill or create particles. You should be able to have creation or destruction of mass during the transportation. So it's also something very important for me because it's a way to stress that there is two geometries on probability measure. There is a geometry of transportation, which is like the Lagrangian geometry or the advection geometry, and then there is a geometry of rather Eulerian of creation or destruction of mass. If you want, it's like the horizontal versus the vertical geometry. The geometry of merge of particles versus the geometry of weights. And the idea of unbalanced optimal transport is to hybridize the two together. If you want something that mixes or sums together these two geometries. It's very natural actually to do. In many situations, it's not true that things are only manipulating by moving the mass or by changing the weight. Usually what happens is a mix of the two. And a typical illustration is in biological models, for instance, where you want to model, for instance, the growth or the evolution of tumors or the evolution of cells. What will happen is they will move. But also you would have birth or death of particles. So you typically have these two phenomena together. And it turned out that this can be written in a very simple way in the Kantorovich formulation. So there are several papers on this. One paper is by the team of Liero, Milke, and Savary that did an amazing work. It's a big paper of more than 100 pages that has a lot of details and a lot of extension. And at the same time, we did a paper on exactly the same formulation, but on a simpler setup. So I would say this paper is like the definitive one, and our paper is, we did the case basically in Euclidean space. And there is another related paper by Kondragiev, Lenormand Saint-Jean, and Rotnikov that rather studies the dynamical formulation. So which is a specific or a subclass, which is also contained in this paper. So this paper is like a superset of all the other papers that were at the same time proposed, but they all come up surprisingly with the same exact idea, which is super simple. And in its most simple instantiation is just this equation, which I will comment. The idea is, what is the problem with optimal transport? The problem is you impose exact conservation of mass. You impose that the coupling should have exactly the marginal A and the marginal B. So in particular, if the two marginal doesn't have the same mass, then it's not possible. Because of course, the total mass of P is the total mass of A and is the total mass of B. So if A and B doesn't have the total mass, optimal transport has no solution. There is no feasible P. So what you I would say, as an optimizer or as a machine learner, what you should do is, instead of imposing strict conservation of mass, you just penalize it in a soft way. You just penalize the fact that you want this to be close to R to A, but maybe not exactly. So you want to allow for kind of a misfit with the data. If you want, you can view this in a kind of a Bayesian way as some kind of modeling the noise or the error. And a natural way, but there are other ways, to measure the misfit is once again using the Kullback labeler or relative entropy divergence. So what you do is you try to minimize the optimal transport cost plus some parameter tau, which is a degree of mass creation, multiply by a deviation to the marginal constraint. So if you want, as tau goes to plus infinity, you would come back to classical optimal transport. So in the case tau is infinity, of course you need to have P1 equal alpha, so you need to have exact conservation of mass. But as you decrease tau, you would have something that is softer and softer that allows you to have creation or destruction of mass. it's kind of makes sense. It's very intuitive, but this formula looks like a ad hoc formula. I mean, why should you use this one? In fact, what we proved and what the other proved here is that actually this is a very natural formula. First, it's defined a distance, which is not so obvious when you use this. In fact, we proved that it's a distance. It's actually a geodesic distance if d is, for instance, the Euclidean norm. And it has exactly all the nice properties of the Wasserstein 2 distance. In fact, if you look at the Riemannian point of view, this is exactly the W2 distance equipped with also a term that allows you to change the mass. So it's kind of, if you want, a summation of the Riemannian tensor. So it's really, in fact, if you think a bit about this, this is the canonical way to extend the Wasserstein 2, the geodesic Wasserstein 2 distance. Instead of being a distance on probability distribution, now it's a distance on any positive measures. And you also have a natural dynamical formulation, and the interpretation of the dynamical formulation, the geodesic, if you want, is that you have also a source term in the equation. You have the ability to create mass by having some creation of mass. So I don't detail this, I don't want to go into detail, but the take home message is this formula, although it looks like a hack, is actually a very deep or very natural way to compare two distributions when they don't have exactly the same mass. And just to further give insight on this, I will give you this geodesic on two particular cases. So on the right, you have the geodesics for the Wasserstein distance, which is what happens when tau goes to infinity. So you have a balanced transport if you want. On the left, you have what happens when tau goes to zero. And in fact, it's a bit of computation, but if tau goes to zero, might look a bit surprising, but the limiting distance is what is called the Ellinger distance, which is a beautiful distance. It's basically the L2 norm of the square root. And taking the square root of a probability makes a lot of sense because then it becomes like a unit vector on the sphere. So it's kind of a very, very natural distance. Okay. So if you want, in this limit, the geometry is a Ellinger geometry, which is like the L2 geometry. So it's like a horizontal interpolation. So in the left limit, you only have like teleportation of mass, and you have just like this kind of movement. On the right, what you have is optimal transport, so you just get like horizontal displacement. And you really see the two problems you have with this and this. So here what I do is I want to interpolate between the red and the blue, which is just a mixture of two Gaussians. But I played a bit of a trick because I've done on purpose the fact that this red bump has a little bit more of mass than this blue bump. Okay? So if you look at what happened with optimal transport, it's impossible for him to send this red bump to this blue bump because they don't have the same mass. So it's exactly the problem I was highlighting yesterday when I speak about Figali's results. Is in this case, optimal transport, it needs to split this mass in two and to send a little bit like a soliton that travels all the way from this guy to this guy to ensure the conservation of mass. So when you don't have exact local balance, even if the mass is globally balanced, so you can still do optimal transport, the result is a disaster because the optimal transport is very irregular because it will split your mass in two parts. And it's typically what happens in real life. In real life, it's never the case that you have this nice balance and optimal transport will be smooth. You always have a lot of noise and mistakes. So it will typically have lots of errors that will move all around the place because it wants to maintain the conservation of mass. This is what happened with classical optimal transport. The transport map is very irregular. With Ellinger, well, there is no transport. What happened is just teleportation. This mass gets teleported here, for instance, at infinite speed. So because you just do like this kind of variation, there is no transfer of mass. There is just destruction of mass and creation of mass, which is a totally opposite behavior. And here you have something in between, where what happens, where tau is between zero and plus infinity, is you have this red bump that gets mapped to this blue bump, and the mass gets a bit destroyed. So here you have a bit of death of particles, if you want, and here you have the opposite, you have a bit of a creation of particle. So I don't explain how I do the drawing, there is a numerical code to actually do this interpolation, but this is just to explain the intuition of what happened when you mix Ellinger with Wasserstein. So actually in this paper, they call this Monge-Kantorowicz-Ellinger. And in our paper, we call this Wasserstein-Fischer-Hao. But the reason is that Ellinger is the distance associated to the Fischer-Hao metric. So it's just the same exact thing, except that they took like the name Ellinger and we took the name Fischer-Hao. But it's exactly the same metric. So this is a mix between Monge-Kantorowicz-Wasserstein and Ellinger-Fischer-Hao. And of course, you can do other things at Killback Labeler, and this would be a bit different, but you can also do the math and also the algorithm. And the and something that is also very nice is SYNCHRON extends like almost trivially with this. You just reduce the computation on the reverse blackboard, you just compute the differential of this function, and then by magic, you would see appearing these two fixed point iterations that are almost the same as SYNCHRON. The only difference is once you have computed the ratio between what you want and what you get, is you need to raise it to some power strictly larger than one. So if epsilon, if tau is plus infinity, then you raise to the power one, you get SYNCHRON. But if you want to have a bit of unbalancedness, you raise it to some power that is a bit larger than one. So you see it's the same algorithm, but then it gives you the solution to the unbalanced optimal transport problem. And you have variation on it. If instead of having Kullback, instead of having a power operation, you have another operation, but it's pretty much exactly the same idea. Just to say, okay, the algorithm extends. Another very interesting extension, which is due to Guillaume Carlier and Marcel Aguet. So unfortunately, Marcel died, I think, a bit more than 1 year ago, but he was really one of the key players in optimal transport. And together with Guillaume, they derived basically an extension of Brunier's theory to the case of Barry Santer, where instead of doing optimal transport between two measures, now you try to couple together several measures. It's kind of a general class of problem, and the most iconic problem is the Barry Santer, where the coupling is just done by what is called computing a Fréchet mean. So you have some input measure, alpha s, and you want to compute the notion of Barry Santer. And what you say is the Barry Santer would be minimizing a weighted sum of a certain distance. And it's very natural because it's kind of a generalization of the classical Barry Santer. If you took just alpha s to be just a Dirac, and beta to be just a single Dirac, then the optimal transport is just the distance between the position of the Dirac. Okay. And if you took the cost, which is just, I would say, the Euclidean cost, then beta star would be a Dirac at position, let's say, y star. That is minimizing over y the sum of lambda s xs minus y square. And you know that the solution to this problem is just the Barry Santer sum of lambda s xs, if the lambda sums to 1. So the Euclidean Barry Santer, you can of course define it just as being the average, but you can also define it as being minimizing a convex function, which is just a sum of quadratic term. So the intuition of Martial and Guillaume is, okay, let's replace the quadratic distance on the plane or on the Euclidean space by the Wasserstein distance, and we'll call this the Wasserstein Barry Santer. And what is really cool is, and I will actually show this tomorrow, is that the Wasserstein distance, not only it's a distance, but it's actually, when you raise it to the power p, it's a convex function of both of its inputs. Which is amazing, because usually distance, they have no reason for a distance to be a convex function. Whether for the Wasserstein distance, it's convex. So it means this optimization problem, it's a Barry Santer problem, but a Fréchet mean problem, but it's also a convex optimization problem, which is rarely the case. Which allows you to like do all the math very easily. For instance, what they were able to show, which is an extension of Brunier's theorem, if one of the inputs is non-singular, is like having a density, then the Barry Santer exists, is unique, and is defined by a Monge map from this measure to the Barry Santer. And you have equation on the Monge map, you have like Monge Ampere type problems. So really, like everything you love about optimal transport, it extends exactly verbatim to Barry Santer. You also have the Barry Santer of Gaussian, which is a Gaussian. So it's really beautiful. So you can view this as, instead of trying to Barry Santer points, you can Barry Santer group of points, or you can Barry Santer shapes, for instance. So this is a code, this is solved with the algorithm I will explain, but you are given like a uniform measure inside a shape, if you want. It's like a clay or plastic model, if you want, and you'd like to average them together. So it's a very dumb way to average it, but it's also a very simple way. What we did is we simply solve this problem, and you get then a density measure, which you call it your average shape. So disclaimer, you are not averaging shapes, you are averaging densities or probability distribution, which is different, okay? But here I'm cheating a bit because I'm just displaying, if you want, the level set of the probability distribution in order to retrieve a shape. But typically, if you have two uniform measures, there's usually no reason for the Barry Santer to be also a uniform measure on the shape. Okay. Which makes sense because what you do when you do this idea of barista entering shape or surfaces is you basically break your shape in tons of small particles and then you make the particles evolve in order to create the barycenter. So you're more like averaging particles than really averaging shapes. And people that know about how you do barycenter of shapes, they know that it's much more complicated than this. Because you need to model the surface, you need to take into account a lot of stuff, so it's much more complicated. But nevertheless, okay, it was fun to do it. And the idea is actually Sinkhorn algorithm also extends very simply to this problem. You do the same trick as before, you write down the first order condition, you manipulate them, and then you get fixed point equation. So we did a paper on this. And the intuition is also quite simple. This is like connecting your barycenter to alpha s. So the idea of this algorithm, it will run in parallel several Sinkhorn. So here, to compute this barycenter, it will run in parallel three Sinkhorn. But at each iteration, or maybe each 10 iteration, whatever, you need to resynchronize them together by saying that the marginal needs to be the barycenter. And it's exactly the intuition between this algorithm, is you have a Sinkhorn algorithm on alpha s, Sinkhorn algorithm on beta, which is the barycenter. And each now and then, you need to resynchronize them. And okay, you need to do the math, but if you do the math, you will see that the resynchronization of the barycenter is just the geometric mean of the marginal that you have computed. So it's kind of just Sinkhorn that run in parallel, but from time to time you recompute the barycenter by saying, okay, each one will vote for its favorite barycenter, and you just average them together. But this is simply, you can also view this algorithm as just a standard convex optimization scheme to solve this problem. All right. Maybe I'll mention a bit of convergence, I don't know. Okay, maybe I do the convergence 5 minutes, and after we do the break, because you are still still awake. So let's finish on this, and then we switch to more machine learning type application. So I just wanted to highlight the key aspect of convergence, not go through all the theory, but give you how you prove convergence, and I think there is a very nice idea that maybe you could use for other problems. I don't know. Well, the first idea is just apply your favorite convex optimization knowledge and apply this to this problem. And it works, but unfortunately, it's not very powerful. It gives you poor rates, and it doesn't work for infinite dimensional problems. And a way to view this is simply, sorry, I should maybe have erased this, but whatever. Maybe it's after. Yeah, I think this slide is probably the good one. It's a simple remark, maximum entropy method. If you have a linear function plus epsilon, the relative entropy, you can just factorize the linear term inside the relative entropy. You just write that C is the log of its exponential, basically. And you get that this term is just epsilon times the relative entropy between your coupling and the Gibbs kernel. Okay, so you can just refactorize the energy you solve using Schrödinger problem as just epsilon, the relative entropy, plus some constant that you ignore. Okay, so which means that Schrödinger problem, you can reinterpret this not as an approximation of optimal transport, but as a projection problem. You try to project the Gibbs kernel onto the transportation polytope. Because epsilon is a constant, and this is a constant, so you can remove them. And of course, the trick is you project this, but not using classical Euclidean projection. You project it using the relative entropy distance. And the main take-home message is optimization loves relative entropy because it's what is called a Bregman divergence. So I will not explain what is a Bregman divergence, but it's a general class of divergence among which the Euclidean distance is a divergence and the Kullback-Leibler is a divergence. And the bottom line, these are functions that look exactly like Euclidean distance. If you do a Taylor expansion, it's like an Euclidean distance. So every algorithm you like and you love from optimization, gradient descent, projected gradient descent, proximal methods, the primal dual schemes, they all extend trivially to the general Kullback-Leibler geometry. They often call this the mirror geometry, mirror descent. This is just a different name for the same idea. You simply replace Euclidean distance by a Kullback-Leibler or another divergence. So you can apply all the algorithms you like. You just replace Euclidean by Kullback. And here, the simple remark and the simple algorithm you can use is to remark that the set of constraints, which is a bit complicated, you can split them into two very simple constraints. One is just the constraint on the row, and one is the constraint on the column. And what makes the optimization difficult is the interaction between the two. But if you treat this alone or this alone, then things are very easy. So when you have this kind of problems where you can split the constraint into two parts and you compute the projection, the most naive algorithm is just apply iterative projection method. Where you have these two constraints, you start by your initialization, and you first project on the first and the second on the first and the second iteratively. So this is often called POX, which is just alternative convex projection. In the convex case, which is the case here, it's known to converge, and it's known to converge to the intersection. But there is something that is even more important, is in the case where the constraints are affine spaces, not only it converges to the intersection, but it converges in the intersection to the closest point, which is a miracle, but it's true. It's true that if you apply not everybody knows this, but I think it's a very important, very simple but important result, is if the constraints are affine, which is the case here, doing iterative projection actually solves an optimization problem. It solves the projection problem, which is a Schrödinger problem. So now I have a new algorithm, which is just apply iterative projection to your Gibbs kernel, and it should converge to the approximation of the optimal transport. But guess what? It's not a new algorithm. It's Syncorn. If you write down this equation, which I will not do, believe me, you would obtain exactly Syncorn algorithm. So Syncorn algorithm, you can also view this as doing iterative projection starting from the Gibbs kernel until it reaches the projection. And this algorithm is very well known, so it was studied first by Bregman in the 60s, where he proved the convergence. And you can also prove that it converges with some speed, and you can use it. It's just a convex analysis proof. But the problem with it is that the speed in general might be slow, depend on the angles, and it's not clear how it would extend if you replace a discrete Kullback labeler with the relative entropy. So it's, if you want, in some sense, the speed of convergence would break or would go to zero as the number of points increase, which is kind of not what we want. We really want something that is an analysis that is independent on the number of samples, because if you start having a machine learning application or image processing application where the number of pixels grows and grows, you'd like the proof to still work. So you'd like something that's a proof, not from finite dimensional theory, a proof that is really something that is using measures and probability distribution. So this proof is good, but it's typically a proof that is finite dimensional. But fortunately, it turned out that there is another proof, totally different from this one, which is really suited for a Schrödinger problem. And the idea is simply to say, I will try to prove that it's contractant directly. I will try to prove that Syncorn iterations are contractant. And really, it's magic. I mean, once you know the answer, it's simple. But honestly, it's really a beautiful metric. And the metric for which you would prove convergence is what is called a Hilbert projective metric. It's kind of a general machinery. Each time you have a convex cone, and here the cone is simply the set of positive vectors, you can equip this cone with a natural metric between the rays in this cone. So here for the positive octants, rays are simply like lines emanating like this. But each time you have a cone, you can consider the convex cone, you can consider the rays in this cone, and this will define a distance between rays in the cone that makes the convex rays, the rays of the cone, a complete metric space, okay? And I don't give the general definition for this metric, I just give it in the special case of the positive octant. And what is this metric? Pretty much this metric is the L-infinity norm on the logarithm, okay? But since we only care about the rays, it's not exactly the L-infinity norm, it's somehow of the quotient of the L-infinity norm up to translation. And it's very important because if you look at this problem, U and V, they are not unique, because you can always multiply U by a constant and divide V by the same constant. So really what Syncorn is operating is not on U and V, but U and V up to a scalar multiplication. Okay? So really what you should is to study convergence of U or convergence of V. No, if one converges, the other one will converge, up to a multiplication. So really what you care is rays and not positive vector. So you should think of U up to an equivalent class of multiplication by a scalar. So you can study convergence of U using this matrix, and the L-infinity norm up to an additive constant is what is called sometimes the variation semi-norm, is the max minus the mean. So this guy is a norm up to a constant, meaning this is zero if and only if f is a constant vector, right? But okay, roughly speaking, The metric you should use to study synchron is not the L1 metric, is not the L2 metric, it's the L infinity norm on the logarithm. Okay, and why should you use this? It's because there is a famous theorem, a powerful theorem, which is called Birkhoff. I hope I get the correct Birkhoff, but we can speak of this later. which is the fact that, and I guess it's the father, it's that linear operator that map the cone into itself, they are always contractants for this metric. A linear operator in this special case, but it's for general cone, it's still true, like the SDP cone, for instance. A linear operator, a matrix, if you want, that maps positive vector to positive vector is necessarily contracting, strictly contracting, for the Hilbert metric. So what is a linear operator that maps positive vector to positive vector? Well, it's just a Gibbs kernel, it's a positive matrix, a matrix with positive entries. So if you have a matrix with positive entries, somehow the intuition is it will shrink the cone inward. It will take the cone like this, let's say in R2, if you multiply this cone by a positive matrix, the cone will become smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, and it will converge to a single direction. And you might guess why this is useful at first place. It's useful to study what is called Peyron-Frobenius theorem, the fact that when you multiply a matrix several times, it will shrink toward a single direction, which is the leading eigenvector. So this theorem is actually the one that was developed to study the convergence of a power iteration. But here we use it for another tools, because synchron is a bit of a generalization of this. So the full theorem is like this. So okay, this is like a little complex equation, but this is just to actually the fact that you can compute in closed form actually the contraction ratio. So the theorem is that if you multiply by a linear matrix that is positive, then the Hilbert metric is smaller than a constant, which is the contraction ratio of the cone of the operator, times the Hilbert metric. And this guy is strictly smaller than one. Okay, so this is for the just Birkhoff theorem. But now what we have to deal and this is, I already told you, but the main application of this is to study Markov chains, to study the convergence of Markov chain and the speed of convergence. And you get this way, you get a geometric convergence rate on Markov chain, because Markov chain is just applying several times a Gibbs kernel, if you want. But here we'll use it for something a bit more general, because if you look at synchron operation, it's just the concatenation of four operations. First, a division, then the multiplication by the Gibbs kernel, then another division, and then a multiplication by the adjoint of the Gibbs kernel. So you have four operations. But the good news is division is an isometry, because you're taking the log. If you make A divided by a vector, it's an isometry for the Hilbert metric. So this operation, A divided and B divided, they have a contraction ratio of 1 because they are isometric. And this is having a contraction ratio of lambda. This has also the same contraction ratio. So you get the synchron is contracting with a ratio which is lambda square. So this proves to you that, for instance, the scaling are converging with the linear speed. And you can also then show convergence for other quantities, but basically they all converge with what is called a linear rate, which is just the fact that at each iteration, you multiply by lambda the distance. And this was proved first by Franklin and Lorentz for matrices. But in fact, this proof works in the infinite dimensional case because it's exactly the same proof. So it's really nice. So this I will skip. And I think these are just plots of convergence. So I will stop here, but I really want to say that this is a beautiful result, and like a lot of the proof, because it's fairly simple. Of course, for this, you need to know Birkhoff theorem, which is not so easy to prove, but it's not so hard either. Is there any question? Otherwise, I can stop here for now. I guess no question. Okay, so let's do a small break, like 4 minutes, 3 minutes. I promise you I will show a nice video at the end. So okay, so now I wanted to touch on the question of whether this could be applied to machine learning type problems. And first, I want to start by bad news, is if you use synchron like this, it will not work, because especially in high dimensional settings, I will insist on this, you might want to use epsilon that is a bit large, so that it's fast and robust. But the problem is because of the entropy, then this would be a disaster because it's not anymore a metric. Okay, because this entropy is a term that is strictly positive. So if you want to compare, for instance, alpha to itself, typically it would be strictly positive, it's non-zero. And if you look at what happened, it's actually, if you try to find solve the most dumb fitting problem, you try to find the measure which is the closest to alpha, you will find that it's never alpha itself, it's some kind of a shrunk version of alpha. And if you let epsilon goes to plus infinity, if you take the square norm, then the optimal alpha would converge to the mean. So you get some kind of a bias, which is typical what you get when you do regularization. You get this bias-variance trade-off, and you get the bias that starts to kick in. And if you take epsilon large, you get a huge bias, and it's very bad. So the question we were asking is, like an abstract question, is it possible to remove this bias and to turn this Schrödinger energy into a distance-like functional? And we studied a bit what you could do, and we take inspiration from what people did in Carnell's method. And the way you turn a functional that is more like an inner product and not a distance, if you want, is simply by some kind of a polarization formula, that the way it would be called, I guess. But it's simply the fact that you subtract one half of the cost of alpha to itself and one half of beta to itself. You see this formula? The advantage is, I mean, it's trivial, but it's the fact that when you apply it to beta equal to alpha, then this will cancel, so it will give you zero. But of course, you might wonder, why is it a good idea? Because you have this minus sign, so maybe at credit could make the problem even worse, because it becomes negative and something will blow. I mean, nobody knows. So what we'd start doing with my students, Aude Genevet at the time, is to simply use it numerically to see what's happened. And we saw that it was actually working very, very well. It was always positive, so it was really acting like a distance. And then it became a research problem. So it's typical situation that I like is when you start doing numerics and you start seeing beautiful things appearing, and then you start doing the theory, and actually the numerics help a lot to find a strategy of proof. So it's why I think it's important to do numerics. It's also to do theory. Numerics is not like to solve application problem, it's also useful to prove theorem, I think, and it's the way we use it. And the first thing we did is, before trying to prove some complicated property on this, is we look at what happened when epsilon is small or large. So when epsilon is small, actually we wrote a paper on this with Guillaume, and Christian Leonard also studied this problem. It's the low temperature limit of Schrödinger is the optimal transport problem, which is very simple in finite Dirac's, sum of Dirac's. For arbitrary measure, it's a bit more tricky, but you can somehow show that this quantity converges to the optimal transport with a speed which is epsilon log epsilon. So roughly speaking, when epsilon goes to zero, this converges at rate epsilon log epsilon to the optimal transport distance, and it's fairly easy to show. But the other one is more surprising, and I think it's very interesting, is what happens when epsilon goes to plus infinity. In fact, this quantity would converge to Euclidean norm. Okay, and the reason for this, it's simply the fact that this pi in the large epsilon limit converge to, so we have put xi, but it should be alpha product beta. Xi converge to alpha product beta. This guy actually will converge to zero. And what you would get in the large epsilon limit is that this will simply converge to some kind of an inner product, which you would polarize. So in the large epsilon limit, this quantity would converge to the Euclidean norm. And I would like to spend some time to speak about Euclidean norm, because they are somehow a bit overlooked in the literature. But people in statistics, they love it all the time. And people in physics, they use Hilbertian norm all the time, because Hilbertian norms on measure, they correspond to interaction potential of particles. They look at two particles and they see how they interact together. So they are like really like things that appears all the time in physics, I guess also in other disciplines, and also in statistics. In statistics, they call this interaction potential MMD norms, or maximum mean discrepancy. In image processing, we rather call them Kernel's norm. It has several names. And the guy that is the most active on this is Arthur Gretton in London, who studied a lot the use of these MMD norms for all the tasks you might want to know in statistics. So what is basically an Euclidean norm? And maybe I can take 2 minutes to define it. How do you define the Euclidean norm on the space of distribution? It's what is called a Kernel norm, and for those who know about reproducing Hilbert spaces, they correspond to dual of reproducing Hilbert space. But okay, you don't need to know about reproducing Hilbert space to know what is a kernel norms. You just take a kernel K of XY, okay, and from alpha and beta, you build the difference between the two. You simply compute the subtraction between the two because it will be a norm, so we'll factorize this way. And what you do is you integrate twice Xi against your kernel. So you declare that the norm of Xi would be the double integral of K of XY dxi of X dxi of Y. So if you are a probabilist, it means you just compute the expectation of your kernel on X and Y, where X and Y are distributed according to Xi. So kernel norms, they are just double integral of a kernel. So you see it's a quadratic function because it depends twice on Xi, so it's basically a quadratic function on measures. Now the question is, why should it be positive? And the reason for this is, of course, you need to choose specific kernel. You need to choose a kernel which is what is called a positive kernel. So if you don't know what is a positive kernel, I'm not going to teach you this now. But basically, it means a kernel that if you evaluate on Dirac's, it gives you a matrix which is positive, which has positive eigenvalues. For those who knows about translation invariant kernel, so a kernel that could be written this way as a difference. So if you are a kernel on a Hilbert space, it's translation invariant if you can factorize this way. Being positive is equivalent to the fact that the Fourier transform is positive. In some sense, the eigenvalue of your kernel are positive. If the eigenvalue are positive, then this guy is always positive. And somehow, if it's strictly positive, then you show that it's kind of a norm, meaning that it's zero if and only if alpha is equal to beta. So you see, it's very simple, because all you need to do, it's much more simple than optimal transport, is you take a kernel and you integrate twice. And if, for instance, alpha and beta are discrete, then the integration becomes a sum. So evaluating this is faster than optimal transport because it's just n square operation. And there is a ton of literature on kernels, how you can approximate evaluation, how you can use like sketching or low rank method to accelerate this, which also you can use for synchron, by the way. So it's a very mature set of tools, which is simpler than optimal transport, but also there is no transport anymore. You're just like basically comparing everyone to everyone. Like here, this double sum, it really makes sense that it's the large temperature limit of synchron. It's what I've told you, is the large temperature limit of synchron is just integrating everyone against everyone, and it gives you a kernel norms. So the intuition is, in the large temperature limit, this normalized or debiased synchron divergence is converging to MMD kernel norms. And what is the kernel involved? The kernel is a bit weird, but actually it's beautiful. The kernel is minus the distance to the power p. Okay, so you might ask, oh, it's weird, there is a minus, so why is it positive? Well, remember that you're integrating minus the distance to the power p against the difference of two measures. So this measure is not a positive measure, it's at zero mean. So the question, a very interesting question is, when is it the case that minus a distance to the power p is a positive kernel? The answer is, it's true if the distance is negative, but it doesn't help you a lot. So the question is, what are the distances that are negative? And an example of a distance that is negative is the Euclidean distance. So you can show that the Euclidean distance raised to the power p with a minus sign is a positive kernel if you take p between 0 and 2. But you should exclude 2 because it's degenerate. You have zero eigenvalue when it's 2. So if p is strictly between 0 and 2, then this MMD kernel is a positive kernel. And it's a very famous kernel. It has also its Wikipedia page. It's called the energy distance kernel. So if you choose k of xy to be minus x minus y to the power p, but usually people take p equal 1, it's called the energy distance kernel. And in 1D, it's called the Cramer distance. And for those who do PDE, they might recognize here that this is some kind of related to the Green function of a Laplacian. So in fact, this kernel is exactly a kernel associated to a Sobolev space. Okay, so those who know Sobolev space and knows kernel, I mean, those who know kernel probably knows that Sobolev space are reproducing Hilbert space, and this kernel corresponds to a Sobolev space of a negative index. Okay, so for instance, this is the Sobolev space associated to minus d plus 1 divided by 2.
So it's like a very irregular Sobolev space. Usually people, they would use Sobolev space to solve PDE, so Sobolev space with lot of regularity. But here I'm using Sobolev space on the opposite side of the story. I'm using Sobolev space that are very irregular because they are Sobolev space of measures. So Sobolev space of negative derivative, if you want. So this kernel is a Sobolev space of negative index. Okay. So the story goes like this. If you are in Euclidean space, SimCorn is a way to interpolate between something that is very, very non-Euclidean. And you can actually prove this, that Wasserstein distance is really very far from being a norm, or being, when p equal 2, it's really like non-flat space. But at the opposite, if epsilon goes to plus infinity, it converges to the Euclidean norm where there is no transportation. For instance, if you do barycenter with this, since it's a norm, the barycenter is just the linear average. So you get not at all a displacement of mass. Okay, so it's really like two very interesting. And I told you yesterday that one thing that you should care about is this notion of weak convergence and convergence in law, or the topology involved. So both these guys, they share the same topology. They share the topology of the convergence in law. But of course, since we are in dimension infinity, you can have the same topology but behave very differently. So they behave very differently, but very locally, they define the same notion of convergence of sequence. Okay, but once again, from an application point of view, you should really distinguish the two. They have very different behavior. One is something that looks for a bijection between the points, and one is something where there's no bijection. It's like everybody's happy and works with everyone, and it's really totally different. It's really between something where you assign everyone to everyone to in a one-to-one manner, and something that is more global. Right. Something that then we studied with several collaborators is not only the limit, but what happened for every epsilon. And what we prove is under almost the same hypothesis of having a positive kernel, and the hypothesis is that the Gibbs kernel should be positive. But once again, it's the case if D is the Euclidean distance, because this becomes a Gaussian kernel, for instance, and Gaussian kernel is positive. So if the Gibbs kernel is a positive kernel, then this quantity that I have defined is actually always positive. Despite the negative sign, it's always positive. It's not a distance, we can find some counterexample, but it's a divergence, if you want, that has the same topology of the convergence in law. So it's something that is positive. It's zero if and only if the two measures are equal, and where the notion of convergence of sequence is the same as the one for optimal transport and the same as the one for MMD. So if you want, it's a way to do interpolation between two different spaces that preserve somehow the topology. And the advantage, it's an interpolation that you can compute with an algorithm, because there is many ways you can interpolate between metric spaces, but this one is the one that is easy to compute through a SimCorn algorithm. So if you do this, so I put a bar to say that you normalize with removing the bias, you get something where the matching is much more well behaved. And the price to pay is very low, because usually when you use it to do machine learning or image processing or whatever, you just have these two terms to compute, but running SimCorn between alpha and itself is very fast. It's much faster than running SimCorn between two different measures, because the convergence is almost instantaneous. So these two normalizing constants, they come almost for free. So I guess it's some small change you need to do in your code, but it brings, in practice, a huge improvement. It's kind of normalizing if you want the loss. Probably you'll find it, I mean, I guess if you had to work on this problem, you do a similar trick. So it's a very natural trick to do, to normalize the problem. Now, and I've already spoken about this, one question is, is it possible to explain a bit what's happened in high dimension? And for now, it's really like, we don't really know what happened. So what we studied first is the problem of sample complexity, is before actually trying to solve a problem, what happened as a discretization error if you discretize your problem. And a way to view this from a probabilistic point of view is your model would be, I have some measure alpha and beta, but what I observe is just a random realization of alpha and beta, meaning I have n IID samples. So I replace my measure alpha and beta by alpha hat and beta hat, which are empirical realization of it. And I want to compare the Wasserstein distance between my realization, what I can compute on my computer, and what I would like to have to solve my problem. Okay? And I do this also for MMD norm. And the answer is, it's very bad for optimal transports, because somehow you pay the curse of dimensionality, you pay the price that you have to quantize your measure, so you pay the quantization noise a lot. And the quantization noise in high dimension, it grows exponentially bad with the dimension. So it's what happened for kernel estimation method in high dimension, it's exactly the same. You pay a price which is 1 over n to the power 1 over d. Meaning that if d is even like 5 or 6, it's already something that is huge. And it means optimal transport, the frame like this, if you don't know what is your measure, maybe it's like a uniform measure on a cube, but you don't know it, then there's no way you can compute it. Okay, I'm not meaning that maybe in some case it will work for some other reason, but if you don't know anything about your measure and you try to estimate the distance itself, the quantization noise is so huge that to distinguish two cubes together with optimal transport in high dimension, it's not doable. At the opposite end of the spectrum, if you compute MMD norms, you view that they correspond just to summation of kernels. So it means you approximate an integral by just an empirical expectation, which is basically a Monte Carlo method. So Monte Carlo method in high dimension, they scale better because the rate doesn't depend on the dimension. And the rate for Monte Carlo method is like central limit theorem, is 1 over square root of n. It doesn't mean that it doesn't depend on the dimension, because of course the dimension is somehow hidden in the constant, so Monte Carlo method can still be very inefficient in high dimension, but at least the rate doesn't depend badly as with optimal transport. Which means there is hope that you could compute MMD in high dimension, and it's what people do in practice a lot of time. So the question is, what happened with syncon divergence? And what I've told you is syncon should interpolate between the two. And the theorem we proved is exactly this. It's the fact that as soon as epsilon is strictly positive, you are in the rate regime of MMD, meaning you have the rate that doesn't depend on epsilon. But of course, there is no free lunch, because epsilon is hidden in the constant. And the constant plays, of course, an important role, meaning that the constant itself then blows with epsilon going to zero. So the aim of this theorem is not to tell you that syncon is magic that cure the curse of dimensionality for optimal transport. Actually, you can prove more or less that it's a minimax optimal, meaning that there is, in full generality, there is no better method than this one. And in full generality, if you don't know anything about your measure, you need to pay a price that is exponential. And the reason for this is, okay, if you try to use syncon to beat the curse of dimensionality, it doesn't work. Because of course, you would have to choose epsilon in accordance to n. And the best choice you can do is to choose epsilon like having something that explodes with n. And if you equalize the error, because you know that the error you make between this and this is of the order of epsilon log epsilon, then if you apply syncon, you recover exactly the rates of these estimators. So syncon is not something that will allow you to estimate better the optimal transport distance. It's something that allows you to estimate syncon divergence, of course. So now the question is, what is the best for your problem? Is it optimal transport? Is it MMD? Is it syncon? I don't know. So to the best of my knowledge, nobody has really studied like a particular problem where they can clearly say this one is better for this problem, this one is better. I think it's a very good open problem for mathematicians. So in the room, I guess some of you might be interested in trying to study really like practical problems. Here is just saying that this is something that frame like this, it's impossible. If it's possible, it's because of other reasons. So Francis Back, for instance, studied what happened if your measure is supported on the surface, for instance. So there is other reason for optimal transport that could work. But in full generality, it will not work. Whether these two methods, at least they could work in high dimensional settings, right? Because they smooth things. It's okay, so I think it's an important take-home message. And then I wanted to conclude my talk by some like practical application, where unfortunately I have nothing clever to say, which is this idea of generative models. But I think nobody has really things clever to say on this, at least from a mathematical perspective. But it's a beautiful area of research, lot of open problems. Everything is open, so if you look for open problems, like almost everything is open, so lot of contribution that could be made. But for now, everything is experimental. So it's a question of doing generative model fittings, especially using deep learning. So what is the question? The question is the general question of trying to fit a model to a cloud of data, and a model would be a parameterized density. You could think about a Gaussian, but of course the idea is to move to very complex densities. And once you have your model of the data, then you can do a lot of stuff. But the simplest thing you can do is just regenerate new data, for instance. And one typical application would be special effects or computer graphics, where you generate nice images and it's beautiful. But I guess it's useful in all area of science to have a good model for your data. So it's kind of a statistical parameter estimation problems. So the baseline for this, I guess, would be to set up a maximum likelihood estimator, or maybe a penalized maximum likelihood estimator, where the idea is you assume somehow that your data are drawn independently at random from your density, and you say, how likely is it that they are drawn from this density? And likely mean basically the likelihood is computing by saying that you assume that your model has some density with respect to a reference measure. If it's a Gaussian, for instance, you would use it, for instance, as being the Lebesgue measure, but could be any reference measure, it doesn't matter. And since the points are independent, the likelihood is the product of the densities, and you would take minus the log to minimize, just minus the sum of the log of your densities. And somehow, if you think about the regime where the number of points goes to infinity, then this would become an integral, and this would become the relative entropy. So a maximum likelihood in the large sample limit is kind of minimizing the relative entropy, which I also explained before. So what is the problem, or one problem you might have with the relative entropy? The first problem is it might not always be trivial to estimate this, but the problem is sometimes it's not even clear whether it exists. So for Gaussian, of course, it exists, but for more complicated models, you might not be able to find a reference measure where all the measures are regular with respect to this reference measure. Okay, and the typical situation where this where you have this problem, so basically log of zeros everywhere, is the case of what they call generative models in machine learning. But it's a simple class of model where instead of cooking up the density, you rather have an algorithm that does sampling automatically. And how do you do a simple algorithm to generate points according to a model? What you do is you first sample at random points using, for instance, a uniform distribution or some Gaussian distribution, and then you push forward these points by some parametric function g theta. So typically g theta would be here a deep network, but can be any parameterized function. So the measure you model here mathematically is the push forward of a uniform measure by a complex nonlinear map. And the idea that people have in their head is that this is like a latent space of parameters. So this would be like a low dimensional model that would be mapped by your map to a very high dimensional space, let's say of images or videos. So the behavior you would have is that the measure you have on the space of data is typically very singular, very irregular, very complicated. And if you move theta, what it would do, it will operate by somehow warping the measure, warping the surface. So the philosophy of this is not really, is closer to like a matching problem, elastic matching problem, where you want to make the surface as close as possible to your data. I think it's kind of the philosophy you have, that you model kind of a very complex surface and you want to make it close to the data. And the problem is then Kullback labeler is not good for this, because Kullback is linked to the strong topology of measure. And typically, it would be plus infinity in this case because you have discrete data and like a surface. So this would be undefined. So what you need is to replace the relative entropy minimization or whatever minimization you do by something where the functional involved is regular according to the topology of the convergence in law. And of course, this makes sense to use optimal transport or MMD, which, as you might guess, has already been used a lot, so it's not new. The use of optimal transport for density estimation is probably more than 15 years old ago, and MMD, it was proposed by Arthur Gretton in several papers. So here, this is just kind of a more general energy where you use this kind of synchron divergence, but you can find as two particular cases, MMD estimators and optimal transport estimators. So it's just like the take-home message is, this is an energy that is better behaved with respect to generative model fittings. So, and I won't do a course on deep learning because you have others this week, but just to insist on the main message for generative models is the way people would use deep nets for supervised learning. You could think of this as extracting features, extracting low dimensional representation of your data, your inputs is like an image, and the output is typically a low-dimensional feature vector that you would use for classification. At the end, what you care is just being is it a cat, is it a car, whatever. So typically you have a network that would operate by typically convolution or linear operation and subsampling. And through the layer, it will like progressively reduce the dimension. But here, the idea of generative model, I think it's very smart and it's not, it's actually quite new, it's surprising, is just to run the network backward. Okay, so it's kind of, you start by a low dimensional feature vector here, and you do what's often called a deconvolution network, where you progressively grow the dimensionality until you get a super high definition image or video to get like special effects and very, very nice picture. But really, it's a very interesting idea of rather having a network that flows in the other direction. But otherwise, it's just a classical network. And you try to feed the network. This is an example with just MNIST data sets, so very simple network, very simple data. In this case, you can use super dumb network, even a fully connected network will work. And this works beautifully because MNIST is like a very simple data set. So in this case, what you get is, for instance, a latent space that is a two-dimensional square that gets mapped into the set of MNIST digits. So it's like you parameterized your set of digits, your space of digits, using like a simple neural net. So this is not spectacular. You can do very, yeah, there's a lot of method to achieve this. Often people call this manifold learning, so it's like a very old idea. So generative network for simple data set, it's well understood. But the problem is what happened to very complex data sets. And really it's complicated because what you need is to solve not like I want each digit or each images to be matched to another digit. You really want the global space of fake image that you generate. Like sometimes people call this now deep fake in the news. Deep fake is just like this problem. But you have the fake generated data, which is like a continuum of points that should be matched as close as possible to a huge set of discrete points. So it's like a very complex problem. In optimal transport, people call this a semi-discrete problem, and I will speak tomorrow about this. You try to fit a continuous model to a discrete set of points. So in itself, it's even mathematically, it's non-trivial because you have a continuous model and a discrete models. And you want to optimize a function which is like this semi-discrete distance with a parameterized model in it. So the function itself looks crazy. So it looks like non-trivial. So of course, what people would do to minimize it is they would throw like stochastic gradient descent, which means that they will somehow do a stochastic approximation at each iteration. And basically what they would say is, I draw a few random points from the fake, I draw a few random points from the data, and I compute the Wasserstein distance, and I try to minimize it stochastic. But okay, this is like, nobody knows whether it works, there is no proof of convergence. You cannot apply stochastic gradient theory on this because the gradient is biased. So okay, it's like, even just like minimizing the energy is open, it's an open problem. I just want to say, okay, people would do this. And then it raises the question, which from a practical perspective, it's an important problem. How do you numerically compute the derivative? How do you apply stochastic gradient descent? And this would be the pipeline you have when you implement the algorithm, which is nice because it highlights the fact that you somehow have two neural networks working together, which is, I think, a common theme also in this conference of trying to interpret iterative scheme using deep networks. And Synchron is just another iterative scheme, an optimization method. Sometimes people call this like unrolling the iteration, but it's just like having a sequence of simple operators. First, what you do is you draw latent vectors, maybe 1,000 latent vectors. Then you run your network, you get fake data. What you do to run Synchron is you compute the cost matrix, which is the Euclidean distance, for instance, between the two data sets. Okay? And then you compute your Gibbs kernel. Okay, this is easy. And then what you do is you run Synchron, which is in itself like another deep net, because you operate the Gibbs kernel, which is a linear operator, and you invert, which is like very basic nonlinearity. So it's adding like these two networks that works one after the other. And what you need to compute is the gradient of the loss with respect to what? With respect to the network filters, which looks ugly. So there is a way you can do this, and you can try to compute the gradient of this and backpropagate. So there's many ways you can do this. But just to pause for a minute, it raises the question of what is the complexity of computing gradients. And I think it's an important problem that is solved, is known, and in student usually mostly don't know about this. So maybe I can ask you the question. So this is not specific to my talk, it's like a general question. So if you suppose you have an algorithm, a deep network or whatever, that you have implemented on your computer, and the cost of computing the function, so it's a function capital E between n variable to R, is a capital K operation. So you compute the function in capital K operation, then what is the complexity of computing the gradient? What is the complexity of the best possible algorithm you can cook up to compute the gradient, which looks more complicated because the function is from Rn to R, but of course the gradient is a vector field, so it's a function from Rn to Rn. So who wants to try if you have K operation for the gradient, for the function, and it goes then from Rn to Rn? Anyone wants to try? Nobody wants because he's afraid. No, but you know, it's cheating. And we had this discussion yesterday, and I know you. So I will explain then. Of course, there is catch, but let's just work on the time complexity, and then I will speak about the space complexity because I guess you will raise this issue. So maybe I could give a hint of a method to do this. I think a classical method would be using finite differences, right? So if you do finite differences, you have to compute the n plus 1 evaluation of the function. So the complexity of finite differences for n parameter function would be k, capital K multiplied by n plus 1. So if this were the complexity of the gradient, nobody would be able to do optimization in high dimension because nobody can compute n times the algorithm if the parameter of the neural network is like 1 million. Nobody will run 1 million evolution of a neural network, it would be crazy. So it suggests that maybe in some particular case, this is not the complexity. And probably in many of you in your application, you're not using finite differences, right? I mean, nobody's used finite differences in this problem. So it means in your particular problem, you add some better complexity. But it turns out that it's a general theorem, meaning it's true for any function. For any function, the complexity of computing the gradient is more or less 2 times k. It's basically linear in the number of operations, which means computing the gradient is at the same complexity as computing the function itself. And of course, it's a theorem. It was proved by many authors, and one of the guy that is credited for this is this guy, but there is other authors. He proves this during his master's thesis. But it's not only a theorem, it's something that is constructive, meaning this guy, he described for you the algorithm that given the implementation of capital E, it gives you the implementation of this. And in deep learning, they call this the backpropagation algorithm, but the general name for this is reverse mode automatic differentiation. And for computing the gradient, it's optimal, meaning you cannot find any algorithm that would be faster. It's automatic, and it's implemented in most Python packages like PyTorch, TensorFlow, AutoGrad, Chainer. So there are many packages you can use for this. So it's fairly good. The only trick, because of course there is a trick, there's no free lunch, is it's linear in K, but also the memory requirement is linear in K. It means, unfortunately, if the number of operations is huge, the memory you need is huge. Okay, so the bottom line is if you have a lot of iteration in your algorithm, this stating like this, it's you cannot use it, but you have tricks to leverage the complexity. So there is maybe like at least 40 years of research in automatic differentiation. So believe me, people have worked on this a lot. And the bottom line is this is quite efficient, so you can use it for like differentiating syncorn. Still have a bit of time to conclude. But I think this is quite something you might care about. All right. So just to come back to my particular application, so the bottom line is I have my energy, I do stochastic gradients, I cross the finger because I don't really know what's happening because when you have a finite number of samples at each iteration, it's unclear what happened. You use automatic differentiation to compute the gradients, and you can look at what's happened. On simple digit, it works really well. Just state of the art, but everyone is state of the art on MNIST, so it's not really useful. On more complicated image, nobody knows what is state of the art meanings, but probably what you have heard about is generative adversarial networks, which is believed to be state of the art, but it doesn't mean anything because state of the art would refer to some score measures, and the score measure they use is like very discutable. I mean, it's not so clear. They have cooked up some scores. Because the problem is, okay, I could say my goal is to minimize optimal transport, so let's use optimal transport as a quality measure. But I just told you before that in high dimension it's not possible to use. And what should be the cost you use for optimal transport? And why should you prefer optimal transport over MMD or whatever? The problem is it's an unsupervised learning problem, so there's no clear notion of scores. So maybe a score should reflect your own problem you want to solve. Maybe you are an astrophysician and maybe you care about something in astrophysics. Maybe you are a chemist and you care about creating new medicine and you care about the efficiency of your medicine. So for each application, maybe you have your own score and maybe then you can try to speak about optimal method. But the score they cook up is like inception score or some score based on classification error, which is very debatable and depend on tons of things. So the good question is, okay, then they look at images and they look if they look good. Which I think is very bad practice, but it's something that where you care about the visual quality, and in terms of visual, pure visual quality, which has nothing to do with statistical efficiency, this method GANs, they are amazing. They create beautiful image, and I will show you more. But what is the idea of GANs if you think about optimal transport? The intuition is that GANs solve an optimal transport method, but with a catch. What is the catch? Is the problem of optimal transport, to solve it and to have beautiful result, you need a cost. You need this cost C of X, Y. And I've told you before, someone gave me this cost, like gods or your favorite modeling guy. He said to you, okay, this is the cost you need to use. But for image processing, nobody knows what should be the cost because images are just too complicated to be modeled by some function. So if you use the Euclidean cost, it's a disaster. If you use Euclidean cost, it works on simple MNIST data sets, but on real images, it gives you like blurry, not good looking images. So the idea of GAN is you try to learn at the same time the optimal transport, the generative process, and the cost itself. And the idea is you try to learn the cost to be as discriminative as possible. You try to learn the cost so that the Wasserstein distance is as big as possible to be as discriminative as possible. So the intuition, and it's the main and the leading author on this paper is Jan Goodfellow, who is truly a genius because I think it's a beautiful idea. It somehow created a wave of research. I've never seen such a wave of research. Even deep learning, okay, it's a wave, but it took a long time. Like GANs, in like 1 year, there's like half of people at NIBS, they publish on GANs, I clear the same. So there are like virtually tens of thousands of papers every year published on GANs. So I guess it's huge, but let's face it, nobody understood what happened. And the idea is you try to learn at the same time a network that to generate the data and a network to discriminate the data. Like someone like is creating fake data sets and the other one is trying to find a network to on contrary discriminate between the fake and the good. So it's something that you have to solve all together. And it will be obtained by solving a game theory problem, where you minimize on the generative networks, and you maximize on the discriminative networks. And then it's a min-max problem, and then it's even more complicated because, as you know, min-max are much, much more tricky to solve than minimization alone. Because you'll not look for a minimization, you look for a Nash equilibrium, which is very unstable. So if you do a gradient descent on a min-max problem, it will like cycle, it will explode, so okay, it's more tricky. So there is no theory, but it looks nicely. So we did this on like very small images of maybe 100 pixel times 100. So on a single GPU, you can run this code optimal transport on very small data. On big data, you need huge deep GPU. You have a lot of parameters to test, so you really need a lot of GPUs for this. So this is an example of animation that was created at NVIDIA 1 year ago, and now they have even better results. And the game they play at GAN usually to see what happened is they draw a straight line in the latent space, and they look at what the straight line becomes when it pushed forward by the generative network. Then you get some kind of a curve on the space of images, and this is the interpolation they get, which are like fake images. So these images, it's not clear whether they belong to the initial data set. They claim that it's totally virtual faces. I think it's not true. They look alike, of course, like the input data. But what is true is they can interpolate in a very clever way between the input data. So in terms of computer graphics, it's very spectacular. I guess it's fair to say that even like 4 years ago, nobody would have believed that this would be possible. So it has basically solved all, I mean not all, but many problems of computer vision, computer graphics that people were trying to solve for like decades. So at least on the graphic part, it's a big progress. But on the statistical part of whether this interpolation is somehow representative of the input data, it's not clear, and I think it's not true. I think by solving this min max, by using deep nets, you totally destroy the structure of the problem and you don't solve at all a statistical problem. So I think there is a lot of work to do to understand whether the generation, the data you generate is actually really close to the input data in Wasserstein or whatever metric you like, but this is totally an open problem. So I think it's time to conclude because the slides are over. 5 minutes, so I will stop here. I just want to insist on a few points for tomorrow's and today's lecture. Yesterday and today's lecture, tomorrow will be another topics. So I think Syncon is a good idea because it's simple and it allows you to scale numerically in terms of number of samples. Both the algorithm is fast and also it scales to higher dimensional settings. But also nothing is really understood in terms of theory for machine learning problem. So I think there is still a lot of work to do to decipher what should be the best cost for your problem. So if you have some problem, you can test different metrics, but what would be better is to have a theory of what is somehow a well-behaved metric for this problem or this problem or this problem. And for now, it's not so clear. So what we did in practice, I don't know if you saw this, and this is a question that was asked before, is how you select the parameters. So there was epsilon, there was tau, if you do unbalanced. So there is a few parameters. But what you do is, for supervised learning, you do cross-validation. For unsupervised learning, since you don't really know the goal, it's hard to say, but you try several tau, you try several epsilon, you look at the result, and you pick the one you like. So it's kind of not so clear, so clear issues. Okay, so I'll stop here for the coffee break, and I thank you for today's lecture.
So we have time for questions and remarks, if any.
And tomorrow I will show you some codes. So I will start the lecture tomorrow by a review of the codes. So for those interested in codes.
Okay, so if there are no questions, maybe then let's enjoy the coffee.
All right, welcome back, everybody. I'm glad to see many people. Excuse me. So I'm glad to introduce again Lars Rutotto, who will entertain us for an hour. Then we have a coffee break. After that, we have an exciting section of contributed presentations. Attendance is not mandatory, but is strongly encouraged. So we hope you will be many also during that session. So,
okay, cool. Thanks, Michele. I have to correct you. So I will not entertain you very much. I'll actually have you work very hard. Because we left it off yesterday at a very exciting place of the course, which was basically, you know, the halftime or so. But the second halftime, as we know from soccer, is always more intense than the first. So the first one was relatively easy. We got a little bit into machine learning, a little bit into simple learning problems in linear models. You know, piece of cake, everything's convex, you can do it. We did a little bit of feature engineering, and then we said, okay, let's stop doing this manually, and let's see if a neural network can, you know, help us engineer some features so that our linear model works. And we left it off yesterday with this kind of model, which is a single layer model. So in the entropy loss here, you have a sigma ky plus b, and then you have the w. And the regularization, in this course, we're not going to talk about the regularization seriously. But we see already that this optimization problem now has to do a bunch of things. It has to get us three sets of weights, the w, the k, and the b. Okay. And if we look at the problem, I think I made one picture in here where we said, you know, it becomes a little bit non-convex. And just to start off where we finished, last time we talked about one particular method to optimize these networks, and that was the Gauss-Newton method. So that's probably not so much standard in machine learning to use this method, but it's very much standard in parameter estimation on nonlinear least squares. And I think we even ran an experiment, and that turned out to be actually quite nice. I can just rerun this real quick and talk a little bit about it. Because I upgraded my plotting today, I figured this is kind of nice to also show you a little bit about the optimization. So this was this peaks example. We have the errors here, so it gets a decent job done. And here I plot for you the training loss over the iterations. So in this method, to make this example run, I actually had to work a little bit hard. So I did something like this. So for 500 iterations, I used just the steepest descent. Okay. And then I switched to the Gauss-Newton, which then probably took like 5 or 6 iterations. That's why you see this drop. The reason I didn't start with Gauss-Newton is you have to realize that you need to do a few matrix vector products to solve a linear system, okay? And each matrix vector product is a backward propagation and basically a linearized forward propagation. So, you know, you don't necessarily want to do too many of these. And also the steepest descent kind of helps you get into a good spot, because what we know about nonlinear least squares is that you converge very well once you're close to a solution. But it's by far not an efficient method. It only ran so fast and so quickly because I recently upgraded my computer, and because it was a very, very tiny example, a very tiny, tiny network and data set, okay? So today, you know, I want to show you two alternatives to see if we may be able to do better. And we have to probably agree what better means, or maybe you can disagree with me. For me, better means that I want to get the validation error down, and also I want to save a little bit on time. I mean, that's kind of a second order thing, but if there's a tie between two methods, I'm going to pick the one that is cheaper. But primarily, we are interested in the validation error. So that's why also yesterday, or in the initial presentation when I showed you learning results, I didn't really bother showing you the convergence plot, because it's not really about the convergence as of now. We'll see if we can change that later on. Okay. So let's see what other methods we can use. So if Gauss-Newton is not so standard, I will introduce an even more non-standard method. But it's actually one that I'm a big fan of, and I've worked on that for, or I've used it for a few things already, way back before machine learning. So that is a method called variable projection. It dates back to 60s, 70s. Michele will correct me if I'm wrong. Gollop and Pereira, 70s. Okay, probably is here number four. So you can even look that up if that's correct. And it is. So let me motivate that real quick with the optimization problem that we tried to solve. So if we looked at this, so the W again is our linear model. What we know about our linear model is it's a convex optimization problem. Okay, the K and the B, well, I mean, we don't know too much about it. I mean, that's the non-convexity that comes in some sense. So in variable projection, the idea is I use this special structure that I have here. And basically, let's say I have K and B fixed. I know then that getting the W is just extreme learning. And we know how to do that. Okay, so we can basically project out one of the variables. So we can eliminate one variable. So that's what we are going to do. And I'm going to go a little bit slowly here because it's not so, even though it's a paper that is relatively old and then also was used quite heavily, it's not so well known. I want to illustrate it first for a least squares problem, but then wave my hands and say for multinomial regression you can do the same thing. So here's the deal. So say you have an objective function that depends on theta and W. And I use my theta joker. So theta right now, think about k's and b's. And W is only a vector because say I have only one class. I'm going to make it really easy, logistic regression or something like that. So I have a least squares objective function here. And then I have regularization. And I say, okay, I have. It's important to say that the regularization here is basically one term for the W and one term for the theta. So they're not coupled. This problem then is called a separable least squares problem, if you have a problem of this sort. The idea now is we look at this problem for a fixed theta. And we realize that we can get the solution with no sweat. That's a regularized least squares solve. Okay? So the idea is I parameterize the W and make it a function of theta. Because for each given theta, what do? I basically solve the normal equations. Like, I mean, don't take it literally. I mean, I would use something better than that, you know, QR or so, but just to put it on the slide, that's what I'm gonna do. Or you could also think about using a pseudo-inverse, and there's some flexibility in variable projection. Okay, and for now we will assume that solving the least squares problem is a piece of cake. Not always true. There are really difficult, large-scale, ill-posed linear least squares problems. But you know, here the general idea is it's cheaper than anything else we're doing. And that's true for neural networks, because this A of theta here will be the whole neural network in the end. I mean, there's not limited to a single layer, can be many layers. And operating with that animal is much more expensive than doing anything like a least squares. Okay, so what does that buy me? So I have a W of theta. That means that I can get a reduced objective function, let's call it a phi tilde, where I just plug in the W theta instead of the W. So now it's a function not over W and theta, only over theta. Okay? So now now basically what I have is a nonlinear least squares problem. Okay? We may be worried that this is actually a very, highly nonlinear least squares problem. Again, whatever that means, because nonlinear or linear is just, you know, it's two categories. But I'll convince you that it's actually not as bad as it may seem. Because now, since it's a nonlinear least squares problem, we want to attack it with a derivative-based optimization method. So we will have to compute a gradient. Let's see how that goes. So if we compute a gradient here, of this reduced objective function, then you see immediately that there is basically a product rule that comes here that we might be a little bit afraid of, because that means typically taking more derivatives. But it turns out that you actually don't need to do this. So if you realize that the phi tilde is basically, I'll write it here. So phi tilde is basically the old phi evaluated at w and theta and w of theta. Then you can compute the gradient in two steps. You can say, okay, once we take the gradient of the full objective with respect to theta, and then we deal with the other component, that gives us a chain rule. So there we have the gradient of phi with respect to w, and then the chain rule brings us the gradient of w with respect to theta. And this one here is probably the nasty one. So that means you have w of theta as a solution to least squares problems, and you need to differentiate that with respect to the parameters that gave you the problem. That is not such an easy sell, but it turns out that you can ignore this term. Why can you ignore this term? Because the gradient of phi with respect to w is zero. So why is that? It's a first order necessary condition for the w of theta to be an optimal choice. I mean, it satisfies the normal equation, so it's a minimizer of the full objective function that we've come up with. So that's why, so this one is zero. That means we don't even have to worry about this guy. Okay? That way, I mean, I'll write it down here. So the gradient of the full objective function with respect to w is really given by the normal, by the residual of the normal equation. That's basically what we set to zero. Okay? So that is the good news, because it means that you can derive a smaller dimensional problem, okay? But also you can basically treat it as if you were solving the coupled problem. Because all you need here is you need to get the gradient of the full objective with respect to theta. Just mentally, when you think about now how to actually do it, the game will work like this. I give you a theta, okay? Then the first thing you have to do is you have to get the w of theta, which means you need to build all the operators and solve the least squares problem. And then basically you keep going with your code as if this was a full objective function. But you return the gradient only with respect to the theta, of course, in the end, okay? So each call to the objective function requires you to solve one least squares problem, okay? But once you've done that, you can use, you know, gradient descent, nonlinear CG, BFGS, all the methods that you like for solving nonlinear least squares problems. Using Gauss-Newton here is a little bit more tricky, but it can be done. We're actually working on formalizing that these days. But in those methods here, you can really out of the box use this method. And it's been used quite heavily in the inverse problems community. So that is going to be one competitor for me. In these machine learning problems, I have a very nice interpretation for it too. Because we realized that the W is basically parameterizing the hyperplane that cuts through our feature space. And the K and the B control where the features go. So with variable projection, what I make sure of is that for every given configuration, for every transformed feature space, I have the optimal hyperplane. Because if you think about this example with the ellipse that we had in the beginning, I mean, if the hyperplane is somewhere far out, then how would the network know how to push your features around? If you put it right in the middle, then maybe at the borderlines there's more information. So that's why I really like using this method. And you can extend it again for convex functions of all sorts. So long as you can get the minimizer with respect to one of the variables, you can do this quite efficiently. Okay, so that is one competitor that I'll throw into the ring. I think that's just a repetition how this actually would look like for the entropy that we have in the single layer. This problem is still convex in W. We assume that the regularizer is separable, and then you can just really apply this method as I just presented. The other one, I mean, I have to talk about it because it kind of came through in many of the talks, and so far I haven't touched it at all. That is, of course, a stochastic optimization method. Because remember, I mean, all these examples that I showed you, they worked on all the data set at all times. Clearly, it worked for me because I stayed in kind of 2D or with MNIST. But if I actually want to do something more serious, at least the common sense or the common wisdom is that you need to do something like a stochastic method. I will point out that there are two types of stochastic methods. There is one that is based on a sample average. It's called sample average approximation. For those methods, you can still use VAPRO and Gauss-Newton and all these nice methods. But most commonly, what is done is called stochastic approximation. So here, the idea is that my entropy loss here is not just an average over some individual losses. It is an expected value. So I have an entropy loss here that is the expected value, and here I put it for the least squares, of the loss that you get for at y and c that you draw from some distribution. Typically, we don't know what the distribution is. We are given a bunch of samples. That's all we have. Okay, so it's a little bit of a subtlety. If you are not so familiar with optimization, that might seem like everything is the same, but it really is not the same. And I can maybe quickly give you a few properties of stochastic optimization methods that will show you that it's a little bit different from those traditional optimization methods that you may know. So If I interpret the problem as minimizing an expected value, then I have to realize that, first of all, computing the expected value is impossible. Let's assume that. Let's assume we have a really, really large distribution, okay? So all I can do is I can basically draw some samples, Y and C, and I can see what is the loss for those examples. That's all I can do, really. I can draw many, 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 and I can approximate this thing. But that's, in principle, I can do. I never get to see my objective function. Okay? And that has a few implications here. So this is the idea. So stochastic approximation. You design an iteration. So you have the theta k and the w k that hopefully converges to the solutions. So the theta star and w star. But you make it so that the expected value decreases. How easy do you think it's going to be to check if the, like, you do a step, how easy is it going to be to check if the expected value went down? It's right after lunch break, so everything is very easy, right? It is not very easy. I just told you, I mean, you cannot even get the expected value at your current point. How are you going to evaluate the expected value at the next point? So in some sense, in stochastic approximation, what you do is you fly blind. You do some steps, and you have to work very hard on the theory side that, you know, your steps bring the expected value that you're never going to see down. But it's very different from a Gauss-Newton method because, I mean, I didn't tell you, but in Gauss-Newton, what I typically do is I take a gradient, compute a search direction, and then I do a line search. And the line search is nice, right? Because the line search means that my objective function always goes down. Or I use a trust region method or something fancy. In a stochastic approximation, there is no such thing. You have to decide a priori on what your strategy is, and then hope for the best. But these methods are very, very effective. Surprisingly enough, they often converge to global minimizers for these non-convex problems. So we have to talk about them, and we have to take them seriously here too. So the most prominent example you have heard of is the stochastic gradient descent. Then there are other methods. ADAM, I think, is quite popular. There's a whole zoo of stochastic approximation methods that basically differ in the sense that they try to bring in some curvature information, or try to do certain things to remove the noise in the whole process. So the pro is the sample can be really small. So most convergence results that you can easily derive are derived for convex problems, but still, you know, there's empirical evidence they also work beyond that. And those convergence proof work with a batch size of one. So you see one example, you do a step, you draw the next one. So that's quite phenomenal. The con is, I mean, I never get to see my objective function. That makes me really a little bit antsy. But again, still, we're going to use one of these and see how it goes. So the other idea, of course, is stochastic average approximation. So you think you have a expected value as your loss function, and then you draw a whole bunch of samples, and you approximate the expected value with an average, with a mean. Okay. If you do that, you can use your favorite methods, or my favorite methods. You can do line search. You know, we can discuss what stopping criteria we want to use. We have all these different things. The downside is that you need large batches. Some people really want to use large batches. For example, if you are a parallel programmer, then you want to have a very large batch where you can have tons of concurrency forward and backward and whatnot. And in SGD, it is notoriously difficult to parallelize because, as I just said, I draw one example, I update my weights. I draw the next example, I update my weights. The communication versus compute is not in a good ratio in here. And the sample here would stay fixed during the iteration, whereas in a stochastic approximation method, you would draw new samples all the time. You would constantly do stuff. Which one do you want to see first, SGD or VAPRO? SGD. Okay, let's play with SGD. I like questions.
Yeah. Is there a way of setting an error to these estimates?
I'm sure there is for convex problems. For interesting problems, I'm not so much the expert on it. I don't know any. Okay. Life is hard sometimes. So let's look at the SGD code. I want to emphasize, I unfortunately don't have time to walk through the whole example. Basically, it's the same setup we had last, we have with the other one. We have the peaks example with 1,000 points. We have the same, so this one here is the width of the network. That's the same thing, hopefully, that we had in the other one. We use this crazy sign as an activation function, but it's really this line here that is important. So that one is really going to control our life, and we may have to fiddle with it a little bit. So what is here is LR here stands for learning rate. Who knows what a learning rate is? Okay, so approximately everyone, but not everyone. So the learning rate is basically a step size. So what we are going to do is, so we have our theta k plus 1 is equal to theta k minus, and then the learning rate. Let's use LR here. Those are just one variable, don't get that confused, times, and then the gradient of, let's say, phi of theta, and let's just say, you know, y and c. So the objective function depends on the weights, but also on the examples. And let's see, so this one here will really change in every iteration. So I draw a y and a c, I plug that in, I get the gradient, and then I go one step with this learning rate. Okay, so it's really just if you are known or familiar with optimization, that is kind of the step size that your gradient descent method in this case would use. So if you think about evaluating the objective for all the examples, this boils down to a gradient descent with a fixed step size. No line search. Okay? So that parameter is going to be crucial. So if I show you this here in the code again, here what I picked is a learning rate of 1. And I'm going to do 50, they are called epochs here. Think about epochs similar to iteration, but not quite the same. So an epoch is I see all my data points once. Okay, and here I used a batch size of 2. So I'm actually drawing 2 examples and do a step. So I have like 500 of those steps per 1 epoch. Okay. So that is going to be my strategy. I'm not sure it's a good strategy. Because you may know this. So if you study optimization and if you study a method like gradient descent, you know that we always recommend you to use a line search, right? Because there's gradient descent is a little bit difficult because there is no natural step length. Think about you have found a really nice step size. It's pi. And now I come along and I multiply your objective function by 10. I mean, the minimizer doesn't change, but the gradient is multiplied by 10, so you have to update your step size. That's very different from a Newton method. A Newton's method has a step size of 1. Sometimes you want to have a line search if you're inexact, but it's always clear that 1 should be a good thing, because basically you divide by the Hessian and then all the scaling goes. So in stochastic gradient descent, finding the learning rate is going to be problem dependent and of course also scaling dependent. I really cannot give you any advice how to pick it. The only advice I can give you is try and see how it goes. So we'll see how it goes, and then maybe we can see. Oh, why do I have this? Maybe we can see something that is interesting here. So we have that. Okay, so here are now my iterations. It's a little bit artificially slow because it's a MATLAB code and MATLAB doesn't like for loops too much. And you think about this is a big for loop with not so much action. So it is not very happy here. So if you do this in a real programming language, SGD will actually not be that slow. And I didn't do it on purpose. I didn't put like pauses or so in my code. So, okay, let's first of all maybe check what the results look like. A little bit of prep that I need to do. So, here is the loss function. So, we do decrease the loss. Actually, here it almost looks to me that who has played a little bit with these methods, that the learning rate probably could be larger. Because here it looks too good. So basically, I should say that in the loss function plot here, what I do is I actually evaluate the loss for all the examples that I have. Because I don't like too much flying blind. So in a normal code, you wouldn't do that. Because you want to save costs as much as possible and cut corners. But here, actually, it seems to go down monotonically. That is not typically what happens in SGD. And I think I can generate, I can make this to be a little bit wilder and more interesting. But we do see that the result is actually okay. I mean, it's roughly getting the classes, it's training very well. And it's validating also okay. I don't remember what we had for the Newton CG. So it's in the same ballpark. It's 2.4 versus 2.7%. I mean, no one's going to make a big fuss over that. But interestingly, the Newton method is not generalizing much worse, which sometimes is kind of the rumor out on the street. So let's have go faster here. Have a bigger learning rate. And then, so here on the left, you see the loss. So there, you actually see something nice. It's going up and down and up and down and up and down. Okay, so that's typically what happens. If you have a large learning rate, then you see these oscillations in there, and we will probably see that in the plot also in a little bit. Okay, great. How cool is that? So here you see like it's going up and down and up and down, and we just went from a learning rate of 1 to a learning rate of 10. Okay? So now, as Alessandro also mentioned, I mean, this is kind of a really addictive game that you can play here. So maybe, you know, maybe we should actually use Pi as a learning rate. It's kind of in the middle. And see if we can find a good solution. But I think one take-home message from those experiments is that you know, there is—it's not an out-of-the-box method that you can use. I mean, I know so some of these stochastic methods they do better. So this is a plain SGD with no tricks. So there are methods called ADAM and others where there is some predetermined learning rate that seems to work for most problems. By the way, we can also have a smaller learning rate. Let's also run that, because larger here doesn't seem to be the way to go. So there are methods that calibrate the parameters automatically for you. But even those are not descent methods. So it might be that during your optimization, you have a nice spot, and then the objective function grows again. So if you use those methods, you probably want to, what's commonly done, I think, is to store the best iterate that you found. So here now it actually converges. So with a smaller learning rate, it in this example converges a little bit nicer. Yeah?
Can you change the learning rate during the iteration?
Of course.
And what is the best way to change?
The best way to change the learning rate during the optimization, there are a bunch of routes. So if you look into, so this method, by the way, with a fixed learning rate is not guaranteed to converge, even for a convex problem. So to show convergence, you need to use a decaying step size or learning rate. Then there are various things. You wanted, I think, to be summable and square summable. There are a couple of different options how you decay it. Mostly what we do, and also what I think other people are doing, is you use a fixed learning rate. With a fixed learning rate, you are guaranteed to, for a convex problem, you're guaranteed to converge close to a minimizer with a certain radius. So you know, you would realize that typically here you're leveling off. Maybe it's only going up and down and up and down, but staying there. And so that is a sign then to manually interfere. So you actually need to, I think there's a word for this in machine learning, so babysitting the learning process. So you need to sit there and watch. And you know, at this point you jump in and you say, okay, let's divide the learning rate by 4 or by 2 or whatever your lucky number is. So that's how it goes. I mean, these new methods like ADAM, I think they're a little bit better in the sense that you can more easily get them working, but they don't work necessarily out of the box like you are used to from line search methods or so.
Well, so why don't you use a learning rate which depends on the curvature?
Yeah, that is kind of the idea of ADAM and those schemes.
Okay.
That, I mean, oftentimes works better, but not always, at least in my experience. But sure, you know, and then the question is, you know, where all these methods, ADAM, ADAGRAD, ADADelta, all these zoo, kind of where they are, the difference is how you build in the curvature information. But yeah, that's definitely...
Some approximation of it, of course, without having to compute second derivative. Maybe some approximation based on first derivatives.
Yeah, I mean, and also, I mean, you know, stochastic optimization or optimization for machine learning has been a big focus area for a decade at least, or even longer. So there's a really, really, I mean, there's a really nice monograph I think I linked to. It's a SIME review paper by Boutou, Nosedal, and Curtis, I think. So they that is really the go-to paper to read on all these different like stochastic approximation versus stochastic average approximation. Also first order versus second order, and all these things are really nicely laid out in there. So definitely, you know, SGD is kind of the, I mean, this is really the plain SGD. So you can do better, of course, if you do one of these. But it's not really that this feeling of you download the method, you put it on your problem, and you don't have to interfere at all. I mean, you have to watch it very, very closely. But yeah, oftentimes they work actually really, really well. So in some of these complicated classification problems, we see them converge to global minima, where a Newton method would just get stuck. Okay, so it's part of the toolbox. Okay, so then maybe let's go to VARPRO. And for VARPRO, I think my strategy of the day is as follows. Same example. I'm using 10 iterations of steepest descent. Okay. I commented out my Newton CG here. I don't know. I didn't want to talk about how to do Newton CG for VARPRO in the correct way. So here, what I'm going to do is 10 iterations of steepest descent, by which I mean it's a gradient descent with a line search. Okay, that's all I'm going to do. So I forgot to say. So for the SGD, what did we do? 50 epochs, right? So this one here is 5 times cheaper. If we don't count the least square solves, the least square solves here, or the classification problems, which are 40 by 5, so they are small. Okay, so let's run this real quick. Okay, loss function goes down. Okay, fails for some reason in the end, but it's okay. That's the result we get. So you can see two things, and I'm going to switch a little bit back and forth between the tabs here in a bit. First of all, this picture looks okay. I think error-wise it's doing the best of among all of these. It generalizes. And you see something interesting, namely that the loss function here really, really goes down quite quickly. And it actually starts at something, if someone can remember, 0.04. If you look at the SGD, so at the first iteration you're already an order of magnitude lower. And that is because you solved the classification problem. The W is always chosen optimally in this case. So if you take care of that, and the Newton CG, who knows where that is, but it's a really large number. Maybe I can see it here. Something like 3 or so. So those methods start out really, really suboptimally. Okay? And with the VARPRO, you already are in a good shape, and then you reduce it even a little bit further. But we said we want to take extreme learning as a benchmark. And I will say that in the end here, this result is better than what I got in the extreme learning. And there I had 10 times or even more times of the features. So it's not just the classifier that works here. It's also the updating of the weights in the steepest descent. I mean, you see at least some reduction in here. Okay, so that's the example. I mean, 3 different types of methods. So it's actually interesting because typically you have some papers, a few number of papers that go for Newton type methods, and then you have a lot of papers on SGD. But if you do Newton, and I'm going to show you actually why, Newton CG is not going to work very well for these type of problems. And that's a linear algebra problem. Because if you've ever coded a Gauss-Newton method, you know that the big headache comes in the linear algebra. And I can show you some scary plots of what's going on there. And variable projection is used to make the linear algebra better. So it's leading to a better conditioned problem in correct terms. Okay, but at least the good news is we have 3 different ways to train a single layer neural network with not so much difference. So that's going to be different when we go deep. Okay, so I want to kind of, so this is a relatively new example that I've created, to look a little bit on the at the condition numbers and you know, matrices that are involved in here. So for exposition, do it for a regression problem. So I have a residual here that depends on the W and the K, no B for now. And it's basically just a W times sigma KY minus C. So it's the same thing. And what I'm interested in here is to study what is what's the kind of the structure of this nonlinear least squares problem, or separable nonlinear least squares problem? So commonly what I do for those type of problems is I compute the Jacobian. And you know, then once I have the Jacobian, I know everything about the problem, at least at the current point. So how does the Jacobian here look like? So some notation, I think, I need to do. So I need to vectorize the residual, because typically it's a matrix, and then in class we always vectorize things to have gradients to look like vectors. So if we do that, then I can see here the following. So if you have the Jacobian with respect to the W, which is the outer part, you basically have a sigma ky transpose with a, so this is a Kronecker product. The way you can imagine that works is, so this is going to be some matrix, and in each of those entries of the matrix, you have a number, you keep the number and you multiply it with an identity matrix and put that into that block. So it's becoming really big. So each entry you replace with the entry times the identity matrix in this case. So you go from a small matrix here and a small matrix here to a really big matrix. So the dimensions of the matrix that you get is multiplicative. On a computer, you don't want to do this. If you have a Kronecker product, this is actually the best thing that can happen to you, because they're really nice to do matrix vector products, inverses, SVDs with, without building a Kronecker product. But if you write a slide also, it's oftentimes really helpful to expose that. Okay, so that is the structure here. It also shows that this problem here is separable, which we knew already. We knew that we could break it down in a bunch of least squares problems. And the JK is more interesting here. So it has an I Kronecker W on the outside, then the diagonal of the derivative of the activation. I think I had that on the board yesterday. And then here a Y transpose Kronecker. So it's also highly efficient to do matrix vector products with. But this matrix here, since the Kronecker's here are reversed, is going to be dense. Most of the time it's a dense operator. So you have a nice block. I mean, you can group this blockwise, and you have one that is fully dense. Okay? That's already an interesting structure that you have here, and that you can use to gain some insight into maybe how to attack the system more effectively. Because I know there are a few preconditioners here, so it's good to show this. So here's an example. I just set up some network. I think I start with only like width of 8, okay, and then everything is initialized randomly. So I have like 3 input features, 1 output feature. I draw 100 examples that are uniform. I've used the 10H activation, and then what I did here is I kind of randomly chose some weights, and around those weights I look at the Jacobian and its spectrum, or better said, the singular values here. So you see that in this example, I have an okay problem in some sense. So what's the condition am I going to be like? It's something like 10 to the 4. Okay. That's not too bad. I mean, it's something where you want to think about using QR versus building a normal equation, which would square that condition number, but it's not a really bad spot. However, if you go, and I should say, so the reason I look at the Jacobian, just for those people who are not so familiar with Gauss-Newton, is because the Jacobian, I need to solve basically least squares problem with the Jacobian to get my search direction in each iteration. And I'm going to do that with an iterative method, which is making the singular values here of crucial importance. So let's see what happens if I use a different setup. So here I just throw a bunch of different numbers around. So I make the problem slightly bigger, or twice as big to be precise. And then I can generate a spectrum that looks like so. That is not looking too good for me. I want to explain why. So first of all, you see, I mean, the I have now 60 something entries. Okay, it's a bigger system, but not so big. However, you see that the singular values decay, and I mean, that's okay per se. If what I like is if there is like a sudden drop, because then I know, okay, those guys I just ignore and I use something like a low rank solver or like a regularized solver. In this one here, there is no really big gap in the singular values. So I mean, maybe, you know, we can argue that I can cut off here, but I could always argue to have one more or one less. So that is called, so this linearized problem that I've derived is called an ill-posed problem. And we know from inverse problems very well. I mean, there are whole books written on these kind of problems. And for 32, so the good news is if you go from 16 to 32, in my example here, the condition number did not become worse. Okay, but that is an anecdote. I mean, it could very well also turn out differently next time I run this, because all these things are kind of floating around. But the point I want to make is I can very easily generate ill-posed linear systems of almost arbitrary size here. And the even better news is so far no one has looked at this. Because this is something you can only do when you are not using automatic differentiation. When you actually compute these things by explicitly, you have the matrices, you can look at this. So here, just to discuss a little bit, so the problem is ill-posed. Means probably we're solving the wrong problem. So regularization should be really, really crucial here. So this is a condition number of j, and in this example, it's like something like 10 to the 8. So how do people feel about just using an unpreconditioned conjugate gradient method in a single precision because I want to use a GPU? Michele is already shaking his hand. So it's not a good idea. So I think you want to look into smart linear algebra here, which so far I haven't really seen. And especially, I don't know if you know, but single precision is not the worst. There's also half precision. And there's actually a good reason people are interested in half precision. Because naively, I always assumed that if I go from double precision to single precision, I get to do twice as many flops per second. Okay, so kind of half, the numbers are half as heavy, so I can do twice, I can juggle twice as many. And if I go from single to half, I always thought that would give me a factor of 4 compared to double. It's not true. So with modern hardware that is being produced, going from single to half precision is actually a big payoff, something like a factor of 5 or something like so. So if you can make a method like a deep neural network, if you can train it in half precision, and I've only seen this in some, you know, internet forums where people have tried it and things exploded. If you can do this, I think you're in really, really, really good shape. That can be really good good for you if you can do this. But those kind of problems become really, really an issue. I mean, even this guy here with a conditional of 10 to the 4, I mean, you want to be careful with it if you operate. So in conclusion, so it's no surprise if you use a non-linear least square solver for training a single layer neural network that you do need to do the things that I had to do, like 500 iterations of steepest descent and then some Gauss-Newton, and even that didn't work out too well, I mean, compared to SGD, which is the easiest method to write down. So that's no surprise. But variable projection kind of I would count into the smart linear algebra category where you use some of the structure here. But certainly, I mean, there is room for improvement. Okay, so with that, we have 12 minutes to the coffee break. Questions now? No? Okay, because then let's break into the next section. So single layer neural network, I told you everything I know about them. So we have to move on and go a little bit deeper. So in principle, with a single layer neural network, you should be able to fit almost any function. Okay. So there's a question, why would you want to do anything different? The key is, so the width can be relatively large that you need. So if you think about extreme learning, we kept adding. That is also going to happen to us in the single layer. If we're not happy going only to 99%, we have to work much, much harder. So there the idea is, rather than going wide, so to say, let's try to go deep. And people have tried this and have reported that this can be much more efficient in terms of describing the problem. And you know, there are also some of these interpretations that different layers learn different things. I'm not so sure always that this is the case for what I train, but it's okay. So there's a lot of evidence that having more layers is a way to go. And I would want to emphasize that, at least to my knowledge, this is not based on proofs. This is based on, you know, the wisdom of the crowd in some sense, and experience. But we certainly also see that when we go deeper, there is some benefit. But as a benchmark, we have extreme learning and we have the single layer examples, and that's the things we have to beat in order to make it worth our time to look into this. Okay, so how deep is deep? Depends who you ask. So let's talk about that later. And then let me just write down how the first way to go would be. So first way to go would be forward propagation, like really spelled out. So it's like you have a y0, that's a data point you give me. I do my linear fine transformation with nonlinearity. I get a y1. Then guess what? I take the y1 and I plug it basically in the next layer here. And at some point, I get a yn that depends on the kn minus 1, yn minus 1, and bn minus 1. So I generate like a whole sequence of these like more and more transformed features. They can vary in size. So you can make them bigger or smaller. Like in autoencoding, you would want to suddenly decrease them and then make them bigger again, as Gabriel showed us this morning. And that's basically the way to go. And then finally, you only take this guy and solve your regression problem, or plug that in. So I still want to have this notation that I have the yn here that depends now on the input, but also on all these weights. And I have my W here, which is my linear model. So this is the structure that I want to keep. So in some sense, all we did is we replaced the single layer by this guy, by many, 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 many layers. Okay? And then the learning problem, I didn't have space yet to squeeze in the regularization, which we should be using, is then to train all these different Ks and B's and W's. And the convention is to use different weights for every different layer. So the number of variables here grows relatively quickly. Oftentimes you have to use different weights anyway because the sizes change. So there is no clear way, no unique way to use the same weights all the way through. Okay? So that is a deep neural network. Like a very standard multi-layer perceptron network. Okay, there are some challenges. So if you think about, you can obviously spot that this is computationally a little bit more serious now. And the architecture can have millions or billions of parameters. It's not unheard of. You have to make more choices now. Previously, we had one parameter that controlled how wide the network was. So now we have one per layer, and we also have to decide how many layers we want. So there is much more to play with. Then you have the SGD with the learning rate. So you know, there's room for at least, you know, 3-4 loops that you can already think about that you can do. So they are somewhat difficult to train. I don't know. Has anyone heard about exploding gradients or vanishing gradients? Okay. I find these terms funny, actually. So a vanishing gradient is, you know, when I go home. Because, you know, as an optimizer, a vanishing gradient, a gradient equal to zero, perfect. I mean, that's my day. Of course, it refers to the phenomenon that sometimes, and I'll show you one example, the gradient is going to be zero, but you are at a spot that doesn't make you happy. So you haven't solved the problem, but your gradient is zero. You don't know what to do. So that's what this refers to. And it's relatively easy to cook up an example for which the gradient is going to be zero, if you have many layers. Exploding gradients is kind of the opposite. So the numbers in the gradient become really, really big, so that oftentimes you even get something like not a number exceptions. That actually occurs quite often. Haven't seen that in any other application that I've worked on. But the performance somewhat is unpredictable. So it's not So for example, one thing that I definitely assumed when I started out was to say, okay, so if I have more weights, I should do better than if I have fewer weights. At least I should be able to get the training loss down. Okay? I think in the beginning everyone believes that's true, and then we all learn that it's not true. Because I think also probably all the other speakers have hinted to that, is that, you know, you have to train these things. And the problem is non-convex. So just by adding more variables, it's not always the way to go. So oftentimes you see people have very, very big networks, but not train them very well. So it's kind of really unpredictable in some sense. For these kind of models, I never know what I'm expecting. Also, there is no clear path of, say, I've trained, now we have trained our single layer. Let's put in another layer and improve. It's not so easy to design it so that that is actually happening. Because if you add another layer, there's another nonlinearity, and you may even do worse in the beginning. Okay? So there was one important discovery. And I promised you not to have too many of these arrow pictures. And I think I broke my promise right now. The idea here is, but I have a formula for this. So you go from one layer. So this basically is this feed-forward type of thing. You get features in, you get features out, and so on. But you take those features and you also somehow put them in here. Of course, this is a very ambiguous plot, because all you know here is that you're given two things and you don't know what to do with them. So you add them up. That's the only thing that is allowed here. And that is a paper out of Microsoft, so in 2015. It's called the Residual Neural Network. It's a very nice idea. And it's really, really record-breaking. I forgot to check the citations before I came here, but it's in the five digits easily. And it's it's an old paper for machine learning. I mean, it's like that is what when it was put on archive, and it was. I mean, it's really breaking many of the competitions. Okay, so this is how it looks like, and we are going to deal with it much, much more. So all you do is. You add this y0 plus and the yn minus 1 plus. Why it's called a residual neural network? I think if I refer to the paper, the idea is that this stuff is the stuff that you're learning, and it's basically the residual between y1 and y0. Like in iterative methods, there are also other reasons to call it a residual method or residual neural network. But then the learning problem kind of stays the same. You have still the same weights. Here, one important thing to realize is if this k0 here is not square, you're screwed. Because you're not going to be able to add this stuff to that stuff. You'll get an error in your code. Okay? So that is now a restriction on the architecture. And it makes perfect sense, I think, for if you have an iterative method background, it would be very unnatural to have your iterate change size. Not everything would work. And I just want to make one point before we finish to say, okay, so the main thing is that it leads to a smoother objective function. We saw a picture of an objective function just the other day in this paper here, which is referenced as Tom Goldstein and his group have produced that. They have really nice examples where they have these loss landscapes that you definitely don't want to minimize, and then they have the ones you want to minimize, and those come from these architectures. Okay, so here's just before the coffee break, I want to quickly discuss that. So if you do a neural net versus a ResNet, and not deep, so I have like, it's not wide and not deep, so four features, five layers, okay? And I have a neural net, and I have the ResNet. Now I'm going to do the following. I generate two sets of weights, so let's call them theta 1 and theta 0. With t here, I linearly interpolate between them. Okay, so the same number of weights. They have different meanings in those networks, which caused me a little bit of a headache to set up an example that kind of makes sense, at least to me. But now what I can do is I can, can only read this when you sit in the front. So now I can evaluate my network, say for theta t and for theta 0, compute the relative error or relative residual between them, and vary the t. So for t equals 0, I should get a 0. And for t bigger or smaller, I should get a different value. So I basically look at an objective function, like a regression loss, in one direction, from theta 1 to theta 2, one line segment. And that is the objective function that I would see. So I see a very sharp minimum mean here, and then I see an uptick, and a down, and an up, and a down. And say you start your minimization here, what are the chances that you're going to find the global minimizer? Not so well unless you are lucky with an SGD, because it will probably go down here. And this is an histogram of the entries of the gradient of that loss function that I have here. Okay? And those numbers here, I mean, the only thing that really matters is to see that those numbers are relatively small, but I mean, that may not mean too much because there's a scaling issue. But I want to show you how they look like for a ResNet. Or not. Sorry, this plot will come tomorrow. I think I have a bug in my code. But for the ResNet, that's a nicer plot. Damn. Okay, that's where we're going to start tomorrow. Show the coffee break. Or you find it on the slides online. I actually have it. The objective version will look nicer. Okay? Or otherwise, you're in suspense. And I can take a question also.
Any questions for Lars? Please.
I'm not sure if the question makes sense, but I guess there are some problems where when you have those extra layers in a deep architecture, it depends on the size of the layer, I mean the result. You can probably get better when you actually have a bigger...
What you hope, but it's not always.
Not always, but I guess there are some problems when that happens, right?
Yeah, sure.
So how would the residual network work there? Because in the residual, you have a fixed size of...
I can quickly show you that. That question actually makes a lot of sense. So what you can do is, so here it seems that you are stuck with whatever number of features you have. Of course, and if you read the original paper carefully, you would replace this Y0 with the output of one single layer, for example. Okay? So you take the Y0, and there you use a matrix that is as wide as you like it to be, and then you put that stuff into your ResNet. So since the neural network training is based basically on the chain rule, you can concatenate everything you want. So you can do that. A much quicker and easier way to do this, we've tried that also and with actually a lot of success, is so if you want a wider architecture, just take your Y0 and pad it with zeros. Okay? And surprisingly, that going to a high-dimensional space, I mean, it's some kind of similar with like the example I showed you with, mentioned with a piece of paper where you print your data, and in 3D you can bend it in more ways. That can get the job done then. So in practice, you're not just using this ResNet. You have ways to increase the dimensionality, use the ResNet, sometimes even in convolutional neural networks, downsample, pool, whatever. And use a different ResNet on a different resolution. So that makes a lot of sense to talk about, and we'll talk about that much more on Friday. Okay.
Other questions? No? Let's break for coffee then.
Okay.
Let's thank Lars one more time.